Thank you very much, and welcome to the second day of our board meetings on this lovely September 27th, 2023. As you can see, I'm not Amy Costa. I am stepping into her big shoes today to lead this meeting. And please be patient with me as this is my first time doing this. I know she's very understanding as well, so I feel a little bit of grace. So let's hop right into it. Item 6.4 is Vision 2030 Pathways for Low-Income Workers Demonstration Project. And with that, I'll pass it to our lovely Chancellor and Deputy Chancellor, Daisy Gonzalez.
All right. As I make some introductory remarks, I'd like to invite our guest of honor, our Secretary of the Labor Agency, Stuart Knox, and Executive Director of UDW, Doug Moore. So I'm super excited to present item 6.4 to you. We're just getting started with this work, and in the spirit of Vision 2030, we are publicly putting out the demonstration project right from the beginning, not at step 10 in the process, not at step 5, but at step 0. We are just getting started. Everyone is invited to go beyond watching how this project develops to participating with your thoughts and ideas to help shape the design and the delivery of this demonstration project. Yesterday in my cover letter, I shared with you that I'm excited that Vision 2030 re-examines what access means when we lead with equity. We are the largest system of higher education in the nation. Yet 6.8 million Californians who graduated high school have not completed a college credential. This group, I told you, was highly racialized, disproportionately likely to be low income, and struggle to find gainful employment. This is a big problem, and this is the problem that Dr. Daisy Gonzalez is trying to solve in partnership with the Executive Director, Doug Moore, of the United Domestic Workers. It is complex. It is unchartered territory with no breadcrumbs strewn by the pioneers that we can follow. We are the pioneers who will find the path through our determination and willingness to take risks. In some ways, we are taking a leap of faith. Once we find the path, we will go to work like we always do on policy reform, finding the resources for systems development, and doing all of this with community and in community. A partner in this work is the Secretary of the Labor Agency, Stuart Knox. This partnership with Secretary Knox is a great confidence booster for me. I feel I can solve this problem with our team and with you. I believe that when the state's institutional structures come together to tackle the most difficult problems, we have no choice but to succeed. Today, to give you a glimpse of the first step we have taken, I will turn it over to our very own Deputy Chancellor.
Good morning, Chancellor Christian, Vice President Aguinaldo, board members. This presentation is a part of what we are calling Vision 2030 in action. So the next few presentations that you will see as a part of this agenda are the urgent action. We have said this is a roadmap for action. And so you'll see it live. There is no PowerPoint. You just have a panel of experts because this work is happening in real time. As Chancellor Christian shared, not just in our opening remarks yesterday, but this morning, this has never been done at this scale, at a statewide scale, or led by the Chancellor's office, which means that it requires all of us to solve this problem, including you. And so with this presentation, we hope to catch you up. This partnership with United Domestic Workers is about untapping the potential of adult working learners. It really is the synergy of everything that our campuses are already doing really well with the innovation that needs to be scaled up. So yes, I'm talking about guided pathways, credit for prior learning, competency-based education, and tackling basic needs at scale. Because the reality is many of these learners can already enter our colleges, but what are they entering? And you've heard this office say this before. This partnership is about dismantling barriers for learners and building the right pathways for UDW learners. For us, this is also a really critical time as this agency under the leadership of Chancellor Christian really seeks to create the connections back to other statewide agencies. So thank you for being here, Secretary Knox. Our timeline has been really quick from having Chancellor Christian in this office to having a meeting, Doug Moore in San Diego, to then convening the right team to really lead this. So I want to make sure that I pause and say thank you to Dr. Bull, who, if you attended the DI Institute, you know him, Sandra Sanchez, our interim vice chancellor, Craig Hayward, our general counsel. It has been a team effort from this office. I met Doug in late June in San Diego for the very first time. And as soon as I met him, I came back and the chancellor and I discussed about the potential to do this. And it was really a vision of something she had led locally and thinking about how we could scale this up. By August 18, we were having our first team meeting and really dreaming and what Doug calls a leap of faith to do this work. By September 6, we were really solidifying what a partnership could look like. And I want to share with you what we jointly agreed to. This is about having a long-term partnership. In the meantime, it is a three-year partnership to, quote, ensure the engagement, enrollment, and equitable student success of more than 171,000 UDW members and their dependents, to access California community colleges to empower their social economic upward mobility and long-term civic engagement. That is what we seek to do with this project. It is a three-phase project. The most immediate phase, which is where we are at this moment in time, is to identify the needs of UDW learners. The second phase is about a partnership with Chaffey College, as you heard the chancellor say yesterday, as well as a handful of colleges who can design for UDW relevant programs at the same urgency and in the modality that UDW learners need. The last phase is about effectively launching this partnership and evaluation. We do see a long-term potential to use this as a model statewide and across different fields. Now, what does that mean? Why is this so unique? Why do we say it's never been done? This partnership with UDW is about jointly designing, which means having shared responsibility. So at the heart of this relationship, specifically for UDW, they are a part of 8 different levels of co-designing. The first level and the request is for them to leverage all of their existing infrastructure. This means existing grants through other state agencies, their staff, their buildings, you name it. The second level is about sharing and collecting all relevant data that can help our colleges and this office, Dr. Craig Hayward, really design and really use that as the engine for designing for now and into the future. As a part of this partnership, this is also about having UDW and his leadership team at the table when our colleges do program design and resource mapping. In this shared responsibility, they also share the responsibility for onboarding and counseling and co-designing with our colleges, resource mapping, as well as thinking through how we remove barriers for students. UDW has signed on to really think through textbook cost, emergency housing, and childcare, because it's already at the heart of their organization and what they do. And then lastly, a part of this is their joint partnership to really track post-completion success as well as program evaluation for this entire partnership. And as you know, from your role as CalBright trustees, this type of joint responsibility is what makes a difference. It's what allows us to remove those barriers to enrollment persistence and success. So thank you, Doug, for partnering and agreeing to be a partner, a true partner in all of this work. The other reason why we say it's never been done is UDW is an organization from day one. They made it clear. We are an organization committed to social justice. When you educate our members and their dependents, and when you seek to create a partnership with us, that is what you are signing up to do. Doug was adamant that as a part of our conversation, he needed to make sure that it wasn't just UDW members, but their dependents. And one of the things that they mentioned, which was music to our ears, was we want our dependents to access dual enrollment. We want our dependents to go to your colleges as well. So we now effectively say serving UDW's 171,000 members and their dependents. Lastly, I'll just share that Doug and his team, and why it has never been done, is the sense of urgency. Chancellor Christian and Executive Director Doug Moore share an urgency to really think through how we do this quickly. They have shared their early data, but beyond that, over the last month alone, Doug has led statewide membership meetings, town halls, bringing together more than 10,000 Californians. And we're learning early things. So thank you to the team at the Chancellor's Office and your team, Doug, because the very first set of surveys that we just got, over 2,200 of them, are showing us two things very clearly, which I think it was really at the center of what the expertise of this board already is because of your dual role. From those surveys, we're learning, one, the highest educational level out of the 2,200 responses is some college. 34% of them already have some college, and 27% have a high school degree. Does this sound familiar? The other thing that we are learning clearly from those responses is that when they were asked, what educational program are you interested in at this moment in time? The number one response was health career courses, such as certified nursing assistants, home health aide, or health worker. That was 21.5% of responses. 15% just want a BA, period. And 14.7, technology classes. And what I have to say here in front of all of you is, Doug, our colleges are ready to serve UDW members. We can fill that need. So with that, I actually want to hand it over to the other colleagues who are joining me here on this panel. I would love for Doug Moore, Executive Director of United Domestic Workers, to share a little bit about who his members are, the impact of this partnership to his members, to the families, to California. And then he will hand it over to Stuart Knox, California Labor and Workforce Development Agency Secretary.
Thank you, Daisy. Good morning, everyone. And thank you for having me here today. My name is Doug Moore, and I'm the Executive Director of UDW. And I am so excited about this partnership. But before we get to that, let me tell you a little bit about our union, our members, and the Californians they serve. UDW is a labor union representing more than 170,000 care workers in the state of California. We were founded by followers of Cesar Chavez, who were themselves activists in the Black Power movement in the 1970s and the Chicano movement. So social justice has always been at the core of everything that we do. Today, our members are primarily women and people of color, and many are immigrants. UDW Home Care Workforce provides care for hundreds of thousands of low-income seniors and Californians with disabilities in their homes, keeping them out of costly and impersonal institutional care. Our family child care members provide early education and quality care for children in their homes so that California's working families can thrive. You see, UDW members are the backbone of California's economy. Our members do the work that makes all other work possible. And yet, most home care providers are making just above minimum wage. And after expenses, some child care providers are making just $5 an hour. So fighting for dignity and respect for our members that our members deserve is always an uphill battle. But it's not just UDW members. Caregivers and other domestic workers across the country are marginalized, undervalued, and underpaid. And this has its roots in slavery. And our members don't just face racist and sexist systems when it comes to their paychecks. Our members live in poor and working class communities across the state that are often overlooked, underfunded, undervalued, and overpoliced. So our union just doesn't focus on wages. We can't afford to do that. We work to empower our members to build stronger communities so that we can all thrive. So when I say I'm excited about the partnership, I really mean it. I'm very excited about it. Our members are the exact kind of people who have been left out from higher education for decades. Whether it's because they can't afford it, they don't speak the right language, they don't feel comfortable on a traditional college campus, or they don't have childcare. This partnership is all about addressing the barriers to access and eliminating them. We're going to make it easy for these learners to access free and low-cost certifications and degrees. We're going to help them with books, laptops, internet access. We're going to offer classes in their languages or make sure they have access to high-quality interpretation services. And we're going to help when they need childcare or even emergency housing. At UDW, we're doers. We don't think about all the reasons we can't do something. We figure out how to get what needs to get done, done. And we're centering our members in this creation of this partnership as well. We're currently running a massive statewide survey to get feedback from our members about what they need from this partnership. So many of them have left jobs and other life paths to become caregivers when a family member or a friend became ill. Or they had children and couldn't afford childcare, so they became a childcare provider in their own communities. But what would they be doing if they were not doing this? What dreams can we help them fulfill to access higher education? Well, the possibilities are endless. Last week, we hosted a teletown hall for our members in English, Spanish, and Vietnamese. A record, not 10,000, 18,000 UDW members attended the town halls, and over 5,400 members have indicated interest in this partnership. So far, over 2,200 have filled out the survey, and we're using email, text message campaigns, and our membership events all around the state to gather surveys as well. And from what we gathered so far, our members are just as excited about this opportunity as we are. They're interested in ESL classes, math classes, coursework in healthcare, and childhood development. And if they were doing the work that they're doing now, our members said they would be social workers, legal aides, nurses, IT administrators, restaurant owners, art therapists, and special education teachers. So partnerships like this are so critical to California. And we must address the barriers to access that people of color and immigrants face. We must work to dismantle the oppressive systems that keep so many Californians down. This partnership is only one small but very key way to do just that. Daisy wanted me to talk about some of the other work that we do in UDW. We're not just your typical union. We don't have work sites. Our work sites are homes. We had a good friend of UDW purchase 3 cows from a ranch and had them butchered and sliced and whatever they do to them. But we get that and we give that to our members so that they get healthy food, because a lot of them live in food deserts. So we also do once a month, we have a food program, not food pantry, not just for our members, but for the community in which our members live. So we are doing all that we can to address the needs of our members. So I want to thank Chancellor Christian, Dr. Gonzalez, Dr. Bull, and everyone at the community colleges who has been involved in this process so far, as we truly believe in a future where each and every one of us can thrive. And I'm so happy to be working with folks who also share that vision. Thank you all.
Thank you, Doug. Appreciate it. Doug and I just met about a month ago, I think, as well. So this does happen quickly under Dr. Christian and the Chancellor's office. So I thought I'd talk a little bit. Well, one, amazing partnership. This is how it works at the local level, as Sonia and I both know, coming from the local community college level. I so appreciate that at the Chancellor's level, we're going to see this leadership with Daisy and the Chancellor as well, to make sure that these localized programs start to be part of the community college system. So as the Secretary of Labor, we're all in, as Sonia and I talk about often. And the partnerships with labor unions has always been obviously part of mine, to make sure as the Labor Secretary that we involve our labor unions in a way that are meaningful for their members. And when I met with Doug, the opportunity was just amazing, because many times you see membership organizations that don't necessarily want to see the loss of their members. And I think that's the piece that I remembered most when it came to Doug. He said, we'll educate, populate, and bring in new members. That's not an issue for this membership. So I appreciate that. Really quickly, as you probably saw about 4 weeks ago now, Sonia and I attended with the governor the opportunity to look at career pathways. This is exactly what we're trying to do here, is develop career pathways for everybody. So whether a person of color, whether it's a person who has no education level at all, but has not had the opportunity that some of us have at these tables to move into an education component. I've also overseen four different workforce development entities within the agency ourselves. We're looking at which areas are best suited to moving these career pathways. This is obviously one of them, but also looking at other apprenticeship, pre-apprenticeship models that we can start to move our students, our training individuals into career pathways within the community college system. So Sonia and I have had long conversations around how do we do that with the pre-apprenticeship and apprenticeship training programs. And we're looking at currently what legislative fixes need to be done currently within our system on our side of the house. I know Sonia's looking at that on your side of the house. So by December 1st, we'll work with the governor's office to develop a strategy and legislative fixes. These could be trailer bill, doesn't have to be anything major. And in addition to that, we're also looking at what funding sources that we currently have. So I went through the last 3-4 weeks of our fund sources. We operate about a $2 billion system of workforce development under the four entities under labor agency. And of that, we're looking at about $150 to $200 million of directing towards the career pathway model. So it's a large dollar amount. It's not as large as it could be. So I think there's time for us to start to look at further development of those programs. We've also spent, Sonia and I have spent a lot of time getting out in the community college system. I think more than I've been in the community college system in the last 20 years, which has been really great to have these conversations with the college system to actually figure out what are the barriers to serving more people, but also what are the barriers on our side of the house from the workforce boards. We have 45 workforce boards in the state of California. What are those barriers to getting more people employed? I see Dr. Goldsmith is in the back of the room. We just funded $1.1 million to State Center College, in addition to a $1.2 million to our workforce board in concert for an apprenticeship training program. Many of you know about the Bitwise issue that happened in the Central Valley. And so that's really funding those workers as dislocated workers. But what are those look like throughout the state of California? How do we redirect funding in concert with our community college system? And that's one small example, but I look forward to working with the chancellor's office to further develop this out. I think there's tons of opportunity. One, we want to see an increase of about 50,000 students, ages what we gauge between 18 and 28 year olds who are disconnected from the education system. So 50,000 new students potentially within the community college system, and over 200,000, that's a huge number already with UDW, 200,000 more adults within our system that could actually be served that are either underemployed or unemployed currently within the state of California. So how do we start moving those numbers into the community college system? Without an education, we know that workers are churning within this economy. We see that in all of our statistics daily from the Labor Market Information Division that we oversee, that we're continuously to see a churn within the economy for low wage earners. How do we educate people out of those jobs? And how do we make those jobs better? Which I think was what UDW is working with the chancellor's office as well. So I look forward for the next chapter. It is happening quickly under Sonia, as you all know, and we appreciate the speed for which we're moving. Thanks.
Concludes our presentation, Vice President Aguinaldo. We're happy to answer any questions or take any suggestions you may have.
Thank you very much. We'll now open up floor to board comments. I see Member Rawlings goes first.
There you go. Thank you. This is something I've been very interested in for a while, and Executive Director Moore, I really appreciate your partnership in this. I'm also affiliated with California School Employees Association, and our members in our K-12 districts are some of the lowest paid in the education system in California. Noon duty, kind of playground aides to teaching assistants to food service workers, all those folks, very similar backgrounds to what UDW has. Not quite as disparate, like spread out, and we at least have work sites that we go to. I think this is a great opportunity. I think the work that you're going to be doing with our office is really going to be, as Dr. Christian had shared, really be a pioneer in some of this work that would really set a great example for our classified employees in our school districts, because we have a natural pipeline that we can follow, but the opportunities, the access isn't there. And we also have the challenge of we have members in really rural communities, and they're having trouble, like, you know, kind of getting people up into the teacher ranks. And so there's a shortage of certain types of workers in certain regions of California that I think this work that you're doing is really going to set the stage for. And so I'm really looking forward to the example that you and your members set with our partners here as well. So I really appreciate the work you're doing.
So thank you so much for the presentation. My question actually goes to Mr. Moore. Can you share how there's 170,000 plus dependents, but where are the top three regions or counties in which they are located? Because I think that actually makes a difference relative to a number of things.
UDW is in 44 counties throughout the state of California. We're not in the so-called progressive counties like LA and the Bay Area. Our largest counties, top three, San Diego, Riverside, and Orange County.
Interesting. Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Any other board comments? Member Epstein?
Well, wait a minute. I'm sorry. The most important thing. This is fabulous. Absolutely. And I am excited about this happening. Sorry for my reservedness before. Everybody knows that doesn't usually happen. This is an area that my grandmother was in. And when you talk about the connections of this work relative to slavery, there's a line and a linkage. And so that we are in part, we are not just in partnership. Somebody says, I'm not looking for allies, I'm looking for co-conspirators. So, and that's a compliment as far as I'm concerned. So I'm all in as a co-conspirator. Thank you so much.
Member Epstein.
I was about to say something similar, but without as much pizzazz as Member Haynes is known to do. I think this is really a great model, and I hope we're able to replicate it in a variety of other contexts as well. The question I had was about the language issue. I understand that a great number of the people in your union probably are not English, English is not their first language. And so if they're going to make the transition to community colleges and we're offering all these different language services, what's kind of the long-term plan about so that they can access all the courses that they maybe are not being offered in other languages?
Thank you for the question, Member Epstein. We have several colleges that offer ESL primarily in our non-credit classes. And I was just whispering to Doug, I wouldn't have met you if I hadn't moved to San Diego. And actually, San Diego has a wonderful non-credit continuation school. That would be a primary vehicle. Of course, Chafee will be our primary technical assistance kind of provider, and then really hand selecting the right colleges. And as I said, that can act with the urgency. Language will be a key variable in determining that and making sure that that barrier is removed, period.
So they'll be taking ESL as well as courses in both their native language and in English?
That has not been determined, right? That has not been determined yet.
Also, may I add, when we did a meeting with our board, we had one of our members who just speaks English, says, will we be able to take a Spanish class so I can better communicate with my board members? Mm. And we're like, yes, they're available.
Good morning. Again, thank you for the presentation. I just have one comment. This is why I'm glad I live in California compared to some other states that I won't mention, because it sounds like this is really an opportunity to be a game changer for the nation if we are successful in doing this. And California, once again, will be a role model for the rest of the country about how to do things right. And the diversity is an asset and not a liability. So I just want to applaud you and the work that we're going to continue to do. So thank you so much.
Member Perry?
I can't not join the applause because this is too significant a moment. And I want to say this is exemplifies the approach of our new chancellor. I mean, it is rapid. It addresses a crucial issue. And when she says the time is now, she really means it. And thank you, Dr. Gonzalez, too, for your leadership in this. This is a new partnership that we're seeing, and it's addressing a crucial, crucial gap in the services and the classes that we offer. So what a way to start the morning, and really excited about beginning this work.
Yeah, I have one more thing. Oh. The right is important for UDW. We have a lot of our members who take care of a family member. And because they take care of family members, if that member expires or they're no longer doing the work, they're not eligible for any benefits like unemployment or anything. So you're adding to poverty because they're not eligible. So if they can take care of their client and then start working on a certificate program or a degree program, they're already getting ready for their next career track. So that's why it's so important for us as UDW to make sure that this is successful. We've seen it too many times.
I'm going to insert a comment here as well. There's a common refrain that we have in the community college space, which is a college degree remains the most important path to gain economic security for Californians and their families. And student parents, even though this is broader than student parents, want to pursue a college education, want to attend the community college. So to tag along to what Member Perry said, this is entirely consistent with this new era of Vision 2030 that we're in, where we're being proactive. We are reaching out to folks who want to come and really providing them with the opportunity to self-actualize. So I'm really, really excited about this program. And our board president is back, thank goodness. Thanks for rescuing us. Welcome.
I'm sure she did a great job. Board Member Brown.
So my first reaction as an employee of the California Community Colleges is that we're union too. And this just is one of those things that makes perfect sense. And I'm wondering like, gosh, why haven't we done this yet? But at the same time, I'm like, wow, Chancellor Christian, you're brilliant. And also, wow, all of you for the work that you're doing. This is amazing. But I'm also thinking about from the career development perspective, how we systematically may need to start thinking about the pipeline going the other direction, because we're preparing students for these exact careers, but I don't think it's quite normalized to make sure that students are aware of the unions that exist in their job fields. And that seems to me like it should be another pipeline going out, that you're not just graduating and getting a job, but do you know about the union that's going to protect you? And then again, that pipeline flowing back in, and we can help you advance in your career. So I think that's going to be a really important piece for us to remember as we build this is something new. But as we build out anything that has to do with career, that we need to keep unions in mind systematically. Thank you.
Board Member Escobar Carrillo.
Thank you. I think it's a great point. I was going to ask about keeping people retention and keeping people in school. I mean, we talk a lot about making sure folks don't fall out of our colleges and our system, because we have a partner who can hopefully help with that. That's great. But I'm just curious how the union is thinking about maybe, you know, providing that mentorship, that extra nudge. I mean, these are folks that are managing all kinds of things in addition to work, maybe kids, maybe older parents that they're taking care of. Yeah, how are you all thinking about that, those supports to just keep them encouraged and motivated to stay enrolled?
We talked about that, and we think it's important that the union plays a big role in that, providing removing whatever barriers that may be out there that will stop them from continuing their education. If it's a child care issue, we represent child care providers, okay? If it's emergency housing, we need to be there for them. Some of the rural counties where they don't have Wi-Fi, we need to be able to provide them with Wi-Fi access and laptops. So we feel that that's our obligation, and to check in with them, not when they call, but periodically check in. What is it that you need, to make sure that we're addressing all their needs, not wait for the call to come in, but be more proactive. And maybe having quarterly meetings with our learners saying, hey, how's things going? How can we be more helpful? What is it that you need? And be more proactive and not waiting for them to say, hey, this is happening, so I have to quit. Get ahead of it by, doing quarterly meetings with them.
Great. That's wonderful. I think the proactive, like being proactive, is just will be so important. So we can make sure folks succeed.
The other thing we'll add, Member Escobar Carrillo, is Doug has an incredible team at UDW. And one of the things that's also a part of the conversations and our partnership is hiring success coaches. That's a model. And this morning there was a new article in Inside Higher Ed. So using even peers. The other thing as a part of our partnership is making sure that there's career exploration. And so UDW has agreed to create an ecosystem of team that also brings on success coaches as well as career exploration opportunities. And that's the infrastructure, right? The structures that need to be created, and they're willing to create it on their end.
Board Member Medina?
I'm so excited because every day I see more policies, you know, in this case through the chancellor's office in collaboration with this phenomenal organization, which is a victory for older non-traditional students. I mean, definitely, I'm very elated. Obviously, there's going to be moving forward more opportunities for older students, obviously, at Excel and the California Community College system. So just overall, you know, keep up the great work. I'm really glad.
Board Member Grande.
I would be remiss if I didn't get in on this conversation, but it was something that you just said, Doug, regarding being proactive. And I really do hope that the first thing that we do, if we do have these success coaches, is that they evaluate the work that has been done by these individuals for years and provides credit where credit is due, so that they understand the years that they have labored are worth transcripted college credit that are going to not only value what they've already accomplished, but also transcript for all of us and help us understand the worth that the work has. Thank you.
I wasn't going to say anything, but everybody said something. So this is my excited face, unfortunately. So I'm sorry if I'm not conveying the actual emotion that I feel, but I'll give it a personal touch. My father was a farm worker, and I was young. When I was younger, I was an ESL student. So I can only imagine the possibilities or the difference that a program like this could have had in my parents' lives when I grew up in West Texas. Now, we had great people around us who supported us. Every step of my career, there has always been someone there to point me in the right direction, from the military all the way to where I am now. And so, you know, when I share my story, I often hear people say, well, if you made it, you pull yourself by your bootstraps, or by the bootstraps, you know, why can't everybody else? Wrong answer. These are the programs that can make a difference. And I'm excited for the future of the children, or I'm sorry, of the children of the individuals who will be taking advantage of this opportunity. So I can only imagine, you know, the stories we'll hear 10, 15, 20 years from now as a result of this program. So thank you.
I'm excited. I already shared with Doug. I'm really excited for all of the reasons that my colleague stated, but also this demonstration project has the ability to be scaled, and we can really look kind of across the system. And the fact that it's starting in a labor union is really the ultimate way to begin this process. And so I'm excited. Thank you so much for partnering with us. And my hope is that we can really scale this across other industries, work with other labor unions, because this is the future workforce, which is that we have to be able to show people a clear pathway to a better paying living for themselves, for their families, and a career trajectory. And so this is wonderful. Thank you so very much. With that, is there any public comment on this item?
The public comment period on item 6.4 is now open. We will begin with public comments in Sacramento and then move on to virtual comments. For virtual attendees, please use the raised hand feature. Press *9 if you are calling in. You will have 2 minutes. President Costa, we have not received any in-person remarks and no hands have been raised.
Great. Thank you so much. Next up on the agenda, we have item 6.4, which is the Vision 23 Apprenticeship Pathways, that's a mouthful, Apprenticeship Pathways Demonstration Project. And we have Interim Vice Chancellor Sanchez joined by some of our esteemed colleagues to present on this item.
All right, and I have some introductory comments here. Happy to see Chancellor Goldsmith and Chancellor Marvin Martinez. Welcome. So I wanted to share with you, as someone who's been in traditional academics, a little bit about apprenticeships, and it might be useful. I found it useful from my own understanding. So apprenticeship has a long history, and it's a diverse history that has adapted to changing times and changing industries. In the 16th century, apprenticeship as an organized system took shape in the form of craft guilds and trade associations. During the Industrial Revolution in the 18th and 19th century, factories employed apprentices to learn industrial operations on the job. With the trade unions and labor movement, apprenticeship programs became more structured, combining on-the-job training with classroom instruction. It continues to be a vital aspect of workforce development even today. Countries like Germany and Switzerland have well-established apprenticeship training. California's governor and legislature has invested heavily in the expansion of apprenticeships under the California Apprenticeship Initiative. We, the Chancellor's Office, are partnering with the labor agency, and you saw Secretary Knox here, GoBiz, and the California Division of Apprenticeship Standards. Together, the four agencies will build a coalition of employers and workers into forming thousands of new apprenticeships in response to the governor's call for 500,000 apprenticeships in California by 2030. Now, Vision 2030, as you know, has prioritized apprenticeships. Now, what is it specifically that we are hoping to accomplish with this project, the Apprenticeship Pathways Demonstration Project? Simply put, can apprentices, while they are working through their apprenticeship program, initiate and accumulate college credit toward a college credential? And the answer is, has to be yes. So colleges participating in the project will map learning outcomes gained through apprenticeship programs onto courses, most likely CTE, and provide the apprentices college credit for their on-the-job learning. This would then lead to an associate's degree and then hopefully onto a baccalaureate degree. As I turn it over to Vice Chancellor Sanchez, I want to really recognize Chancellor Marvin Martinez, who is a friend and a very respected colleague across the system. Rancho has stepped up in various times and in various opportunities to help out the Chancellor's office. And yet again, Chancellor Martinez is stepping up to be the lead for this particular project with 25 districts across our state. So with that, Vice Chancellor Sandra Sanchez.
Good morning, President, Board President Costa, Vice President Aguinaldo, members of the board, and Vice Chancellor Christian. I'm pleased to be with you today to share this exciting new opportunity to increase access to college credit in California. The initiative, the Apprenticeship Pathways Demonstration Project, will create a roadmap for colleges to convert existing new innovative apprenticeship experiences, including related supplemental instruction and prior on-the-job training, into college credit. The goal of this demonstration project is to establish a gold standard for how new and innovative apprenticeship programs are designed, with our student success driving everything we do. By awarding college credit for prior learning and expanding access to new certificates and degrees for current, past, and future apprentices, we are meeting students where they are and giving them the tools that they need to follow their dreams. 25 districts have been invited to participate in a 2-year pilot initiative under the leadership of Marvin Martinez, Chancellor of Rancho Santiago Community College District. The three primary implementation goals for participation in the pilot include: colleges commit to develop curriculum alignment towards new certificates and or degrees, colleges develop the infrastructure for adopting credit for prior learning, and finally, the colleges launch a cohort of students in the pathway. In addition, the California Community Colleges Foundation will establish a community of practice for two-way learning between the Chancellor's Office and the colleges. The community of practice will provide an opportunity to share resources with colleges, identify, synthesize, and share policy issues that practitioners and leaders experience as they implement the Apprenticeship Pathways Demonstration Project, and collect and provide policy recommendations to the Chancellor's Office for Title V and other regulations to facilitate the adoption of these pathways. Finally, as was mentioned earlier, the Chancellor's Office is partnering with the California Labor and Workforce Development Agency, the Governor's Office of Business and Economic Development, and the California Department of Industrial Relations Division of Apprenticeship Standards. Together, the four agencies will build a coalition of employers and workers to form thousands of new apprenticeships for California's 21st century economy and in response to the governor's call to action for 500,000 new apprenticeships in California by 2029. This is yet another example of how the system is forging ahead with our Vision 2030 framework. The Vision 2030 incorporates a shift in our approach to proactively bring college to our students wherever they are and not wait for students to come to us. Today's education system must be as dynamic as today's marketplace and economy. No longer do individuals stay in one occupation or with one employer for 30 years. Californians are transitioning from employer to employer, acquiring new skills and seeking opportunities in different fields. Through the Apprenticeship Demonstration Project, we are adapting how we invest and how we contribute to career mobility for everyone who chooses to further their career and personal goals. I look forward to getting this work done with all of you. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's presenters. We're going to start with Chancellor Marvin Martinez from the Rancho Santiago Community College District, who will share an overview of the project and the role that he is taking in leading this initiative. We also have a virtual presenter, Craig Rutan, Academic Senate President from Rancho Santiago, and he will talk about the needs to have faculty and local Senate buy-in for the apprenticeship development. And then certainly, last but not least, Chancellor Carol Goldsmith from the State Center Community College District, and she will talk a little bit about the opportunity this presents for the thousands of apprentices, past, present, and future. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor Sanchez. Good morning, everybody. Good to see you all. Good morning once again, President Costa. Good to see you again. And of course, Vice President Wijnaldum. And of course, Chancellor Christian and the board members. It's great to be here. I didn't think I would make it this morning. We just, I was at a board meeting. So we had a board meeting last night. It finished around midnight. I was trying to rush the board, by the way. Say, hurry up. I got to go. We got to catch a flight. Got about 3 hours of sleep, took the airplane, and I'm here. Yes. First of all, by the way, you've hired an incredible chancellor. So, and you don't say no to Chancellor Christian, because otherwise, no, I know, I won't go there. But anyway, it's a pleasure for me to be here today. So I wanted to give you kind of an overview of what we're trying to accomplish here. And I'm sure you're going to be asking questions to yourselves. And some of the questions will be, why now? I mean, apprenticeships, as Chancellor Christian just stated, they've been around a long time. It's nothing new. They've been around. So why are we focusing on this now? So let me first start, in terms of what we're trying to accomplish. What we're trying to accomplish is that we're working with 25 colleges. So who are these 25 colleges? These are the 25 colleges who actually are doing apprenticeship programs. And they're generating some level of hours. To drill down a little bit deeper from the 25, I would say about 10 of the top 25 are probably generating the most. The others are generating some. Then after that 25, the rest of the 91 are not generating much at all. So I will get to that and help you understand, I think, at least in my opinion, what's occurring. What we want to be able to do with the top, with these colleges, is that we want to be able to help them with the current programs that they have. So many of them have at least one apprenticeship program. We want to be able to help them with that one program and help strengthen that program. We want to be able to help them look at additional programs. The key to this is obviously finding that special faculty member on that campus that can help them do the work of converting the hours that students have been generating as apprentices and converting those hours into credit classes, into so that they can be earning units and earning credits. So, you know, after I speak, Professor Craig Rutan, who I think some of you may know, he is the Faculty Senate President at Santiago Canyon College, which is one of the colleges in my district. So he is the guru. He is the person that has that knowledge base, that has done this, and he's been able to help our college convert. And we have 10 apprenticeship programs. So he's been able to help all those classes so the students are able to earn credit in FTS. So that's where we're trying to go. And so why is that going to be so significant for community colleges? Well, why is this important? Well, the first question is, why are more colleges doing apprenticeship programs? And I'll tell you why. You know, we haven't figured out how to generate enrollment out of apprenticeship programs. That, to me, is the answer. So as a result, it's just generating hours, and that's good. But what all of us are always looking for every day as a CEO, so what do you do every day as a CEO? You're looking for programs that generate enrollment for you. So if this program was not generating enrollment, you probably didn't pay a lot of attention to it. Not to say that it's not important, but we just didn't look at it in that manner. But now, through this project, we're going to help colleges understand that if you do the conversion, you can now position your campus in a way where it can generate enrollment. It can generate additional FTS, which then makes it even much more attractive, and it becomes an incentive for colleges to want to do apprenticeships. So we believe that this will be a very successful project because, again, as a CEO, every day I'm looking for programs that are going to generate enrollment for me. And if this program can do that, if I can increase the number of apprenticeship programs, then it becomes a significant program for me. So that's what we're trying to do, and that's what I'm trying to do as I work with the other CEOs, is really help them understand that this is where we're trying to go, and this is what we're trying to accomplish. So again, we're starting with 25, and as you know, as was stated earlier, we're trying to reach a goal of eventually generating 500,000 apprentices by the year 2030. No doubt an ambitious goal. Is it going to happen with 25 colleges? Of course not. You know, we need the other 91. So our first step is to work with the top 25, help them make that conversion, help them see that you can also now utilize the RSI funding in order to be able to create new additional programs. Secondly, once we begin to generate again that enrollment, then of course you'll see other campuses who will probably want to be part of it. And so we do have a plan of how to help the other 21 colleges who may want to be part of this program. So we will partner with CCAOE, and that's the Occupational Administrators Association. It stands for the California Community College Occupational Administrators Association. Good. See, that's what happens when you only have 3 hours of sleep. You can't remember it all. So, so we're going to work with them. We're going to partner with them so that we can begin to, in essence, come up with a pre-apprenticeship program to help other colleges develop the infrastructure, help them develop new programs so you can have more colleges who are going to want to have apprenticeship programs. So why CCAOE? Well, you know, in our campuses, who basically leads this effort are the deans on our campuses. They are the people at the ground level who are making all this work. So we need the deans, and they're all going to be at this conference, and we're definitely going to be working with them so we can get more colleges. So again, that's where we're trying to go, and that's the plan. As Vice Chancellor Sanchez just mentioned, you know, we found $5 million that we're going to use to support the 25 colleges. They will get funding year one, funding year two, about $100,000. Year one, a little bit over $100,000. Year two, and what we're hoping that these colleges can do with these, it's not a lot of money. But what they can do with these dollars is find that special faculty member that would be the lead. Why is that so significant? Look, you know, at least on our campus, the apprenticeship program is an academic program. It's under the purview of the Academic Senate. And I know as a CEO, I certainly want it that way because then it becomes part of the mainstream. It doesn't become a program that's somewhere out there in a bungalow out by the strawberry fields. but it becomes a program that you are basically working on every day. So, you know, just one last, a couple of just items before I turn it over back to Vice Chancellor Sanchez. You know, to me, this is, you know, no doubt a brilliant idea that was really developed by Chancellor Christian. And I really believe that this could be a way to make apprenticeships much bigger on a bigger scale, because they're not right now. And it could be a way where we can definitely attract the attention of the governor, definitely attract the attention of the various trades and other unions who not only trades who do traditional apprenticeships, but also the non-traditional apprenticeships. And there is many non-traditional apprenticeships within the health industry, logistics industry, hospitality and tourism. So we really want to be able to expand into those areas. So I believe that at the end of 2 years, we will have more colleges. At the end of 2 years, we'll have more colleges, have more programs that will begin to generate more enrollment. At the end of 2 years, we'll move a lot closer to begin reaching that goal of 500,000 apprentices. I really believe that's where we're going to be able to go. So again, on that note, I want to thank you for the opportunity. Of course, I'll be open for questions. I'll turn it over back to Vice Chancellor Sanchez.
Thank you, Chancellor Martinez. We're going to go now to our Professor Craig Rutan, who is joining us virtually to share some remarks.
First, I apologize for not being there in person. As Chancellor Christian has heard from Chancellor Martinez, I have been recovering from medical issues that have made traveling nearly impossible for me. But I don't know that I would call myself a guru. I was someone who happened to be in the right place at the right time for SCC. Our apprenticeship programs came to us. They have been part of the Rancho District for more than 20 years. And the Chancellor's office made changes to how hours and units were handled. And that required us to completely re-examine what we had done with apprenticeship at our college, because we had courses, which is something that you're talking about. All of our apprenticeship work was tied to coursework. We had certificates, we had degrees, but we also had courses that said they were 216 hours and 4 units. And we had to work with the trade organizations to figure out how to fit what they were doing in a model that aligned with the rest of the curriculum that exists in our system. And apprenticeship is an amazing opportunity for students to gain experience and to have guaranteed employment. But the trade organizations don't understand how the internal structures of curriculum work in the community college system. And so a partnership is vital between faculty at the campus and the trade groups in order to align the work that the trades are doing in training their apprentices with how we generate college credit, how we issue credit to students, how students earn certificates, how students can earn associate degrees. And so we were forced to redo all of our curriculum many years ago when those changes were made, and it actually strengthened our relationship between the trades and the college because we had a better sense of what was actually happening. And for the first time, the faculty had to engage in discussions about what apprenticeship was. Many of our faculty at the campus just said, well, we have apprenticeship because we've always had apprenticeship. And if courses would come through, they would simply rubber stamp them because they didn't understand what their intention was and how they differed from the other courses that we offer in our system. If we hope to successfully expand apprenticeship opportunities across our system, and that makes sense now that funding is not restricted to RSI funds anymore, and apprenticeship courses can earn apportionment. If our goal is to expand this, the only way it can be successful is if faculty at the local level can advocate with their local academic senates about why this makes sense. Someone has to understand the structure of what these courses are, what these programs offer to our students, and how that integrates into what we're trying to do as a wide college mission. And as you all are aware, the curriculum of the college is the purview of the academic senates. And if the senates don't understand what is happening, an administration comes to them and says, well, we should do this. Often the response is no. It's not why, it's no. And many of our faculty are teaching in traditional transfer disciplines. That's what we understand. We understand the structure of what we experienced as students. And this doesn't, this model doesn't fit exactly with that. But when we see the successes that apprenticeship students have in gaining employment and gaining experience, it's an amazing opportunity for these students. And we are no longer under some of the restrictions of what is apprenticeable that used to exist. The traditional construction trades were all of apprenticeship for much of the time in the California community colleges. That restriction no longer exists. And we heard in the previous presentation about child development. Child development apprenticeships are spreading across the California community college system. And none of them, as far as I know, are being done under RSI. They're being done under apportionment models. And so this is a new area for us to work together as a system. So I was called a guru, but what I would say is that a lot of what you're talking about, Santiago Canyon College has done for over a decade in terms of issuing college credit for apprenticeship courses, and issuing certificates, issuing degrees. At the same time, many of our apprenticeship students do not think of themselves as college students. And we have to, on our own and in working with the other colleges, make sure that these students understand that they're earning college credit, that they are college students, and that there are opportunities there to earn associate degrees, to transfer into baccalaureate degree programs, to set up articulation agreements with universities in particular disciplines. We have articulated some of our courses to courses at Cal Poly Pomona in land surveying. Some things articulate well, some things don't, but all of this is designed to get students into the workforce and have a job at the end of their work. And I think that if we work together with the faculty and the local academic senates, and of course the statewide academic senate, in trying to put these models together, there'll be a greater understanding by the faculty across the system, which will only help us in supporting our students in the future. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Now I'll hand it over to Dr. Carol Goldsmith. Close us out.
All right. Well, good morning, Chancellor Christian. Always good to see you, Board President, esteemed trustees. I hope Mr. Rattan is still on the line. While it is an incredible honor to be here with all of you today, I have to say I'm a little bit of a fangirl about Mr. Rattan. He is a rock star in our system, and I just want to say thank you so much. I'm looking forward to meeting you in person and having our college faculty work with you, because that gentleman gets where we need to go. I'm excited about this program, as you can probably tell by my enthusiasm this early in the morning after a very long drive to get here. This project, Marvin spoke a little bit about what it is. I would like to talk just a little bit about the potential, what this could do. You heard earlier today from Secretary Knox about my district stepping in to where students got stranded. And this is not the first time we've heard of private post-secondary stranding students. We heard it with ITT, we heard it with HEALD, and at each time, our California Community Colleges and Fresno City College was there to stand in the gap. Some of you may be aware of the Bitwise issue that took place. We were all thrilled in the Central Valley. We finally had a tech company. We were thrilled. We were over the moon, and we were heartbroken when all those dreams were crashed. But was even more heartbreaking was the not only the employees that were left stranded, but they had apprentices and they were left stranded. So Secretary Knox has been a stalwart supporter of Sonia Christensen and the California Community Colleges. So we're standing in the gap and working with our workforce development boards to meet with those students and create new apprenticeship programs. So I was thrilled when I heard about the opportunity to change how we're doing existing apprenticeships. Currently, State Center Community College District has three very small apprenticeship, but they're mighty because we're working with unions. We're working with our labor trades in the construction trades. We have a roofer program. We're in discussions now about how we can articulate college coursework for union work in our trades. This work has been going on for quite some time. That's why I'm so excited to meet Craig and figure out how to do this with our faculty. The desire is there. The workers are there. Our employers need us. And you're right. The union high-paying jobs are there. So one of the things when I first heard about this is we currently have a grant with the EDA, the federal grant, to work with farm workers. As you know, the Central Valley, we grow over 534 different commodities. We rely incredibly, all of us rely on our farm workers. So we've commissioned a survey working with United Farm Workers and others. And right now we have over 10,000 surveys of our farm workers. Originally, we thought about internships, trying to figure out how we can get farm workers working into tech jobs, working in changing. The agriculture business is changing, and we know we need to upskill that community. This project, I believe, will offer new opportunities for farm workers that didn't exist before. That's incredible. I want to thank Chancellor Christian for having the vision to understand the power of apprenticeships, not only for our traditional apprenticeships that we've been doing, because it's right, this is a vehicle that's been around and Germany has done it. And I say, well, if Germany's done it, I think California community colleges can do it better. So I'm incredibly thrilled to be able to take this program to not only stranded tech workers, but our farm workers and try to get them into high-paying union jobs, high-paying any job, and also continue to work with our farmers. Our farmers have changed. Tech has changed. Ag business. So we have to make sure we have the labor workforce that can deliver our food. That project has been working really well, working with farmers, working with farm workers, working with our community college. This will just be one more tool to accelerate that work. And I'm incredibly proud and excited to see a new possibility for hundreds and thousands of Californians. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That concludes the presentation. We're happy to answer any questions.
Colleagues, any questions or comments on the presentation?
Hi, Chancellor Goldberg, in particular, I'm going to start with you, is with all this money pouring into, climate-related adaptation and innovation, is that, particularly in agriculture, is that something that you're looking at as a field that that could be used?
The impact that it's having on agriculture, we're seeing it each and every day. I mean, just look at Tulare Lake. Tulare Lake wasn't a lake until recently again. And that has changed dramatically. That it is an emergency crisis for sure. We're looking not only at the temperature change that's impacting our agriculture, but also the drought issues that we have. We tend in California to go from drought to flooding, right? So those types of water technology, looking at soil emitters, soil tech, all of those jobs is becoming much more high tech because the environment demands it. So those are opportunities and employment pathways that we're looking at now. Yes. Thank you. Great question. Thank you.
So thank you so much for your presentation. I have a question with regard to what you're thinking is going to be around those 25 and what some of the elements relative, because I suspect that you're going to have the possibility of a heck of a lot more than 25. Mm-hmm. And so what would optimize one, our learning and our success in a limited amount of time, because it's a projection on where we can go. Mm-hmm. So can you kind of talk us through that?
Excellent question, by the way. So, as Member Epstein was just mentioning that, so many of our colleges serve certain industries. So you have, of course, State Center, you have a huge agricultural industry, and there's definitely work that you can do there. We have a number of colleges that are around some of the ports in LA, Long Beach City College, Harbor College, that can develop apprenticeships in logistics. And many of us, of course, are located within the health industry, and you have campuses like Lake Tahoe. Again, it has a hospitality and tourism industry where you can develop apprenticeships. So I think the beauty of this program is that it allows each college to customize their apprenticeships to the needs in their area and to the industries that serve their area. So, and this is the discussions that we're having with a number of colleges, in that, you know, first outreach to your industries, develop those relationships. Definitely bring the faculty members, because the faculty members are key to helping us develop that curriculum. You know, so I am encouraging colleges to have, workshops, roundtables with businesses in their areas to begin to generate interest and to generate support. Also, I learned, I was here, you know, a few weeks ago, and there's actually an organization that works with cities and counties to help them develop apprenticeships. I don't know if you're aware of that. And so there's this person that I met, her name is Erica Manuel, and she leads this organization, and she's received funding from California in order to work with local cities and local counties. Well, you know, I work with my local city all the time. I work with my local counties all the time. They don't have the infrastructure to do it, but we do. And again, this is a project that requires us to get out there. There's no way that you could do this job by sitting in your office. You got to get out there, go shake hands, meet with business and industry in order to be able to make that happen. But as you know, as Craig was stating, Craig Rutan, look, you know, what makes this project different now today than it was yesterday is that we got to involve the faculty right away. Get them there, because we need them in order to develop that curriculum, and we can get that moving quickly, because I think all of us know curriculum will take a while before it gets approved. So, you know, an industry doesn't like to wait. They want to move quickly. So we want to be able to get everything going as quickly as we can.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Can I just add one point to Pamela Hayes' wonderful question? You know, all of our areas have community-based organizations that is doing incredible work in environmental justice, social justice. All of those CBOs are also always looking for workers. There could be a strand there and a pathway. Many of our students are incredibly passionate about the environment, social justice issues, equity issues. I see the possibility there. And wouldn't it be nice to be able to strengthen our community-based organizations that for far too long have been under-resourced and doing incredible work in all of our communities?
I'm so really glad you said that, because for so long we haven't. We tried to do all of the work internal to our colleges. And there is a wealth of experience and knowledge that we can tap into in true partnership and allyship relative to that. So I'm really glad you said that. Thank you.
Board Member Medina.
Thank you. I want to thank you all for this important project. In particular, I'm going to point out to you, Chancellor Marvin Martinez. I've seen your hard work since you were president at East Los Angeles College when I was a student there. Technically, I am a student there. You've always been a champion for students. So I'm really honored, very privileged to see you actually take on this project. And to Chancellor Goldsmith, you know, hats off. You know, your district is right in the middle of a very important key segment population throughout the whole state. You know, a lot of students of color. I work closely with your student trustee, Jerry, over at State Center. And he's a phenomenal, you know, student, always advocating for students. And just overall, thank you. Hats off. I look forward to visiting Fresno City College next month for Undocumented Student Week. So thank you.
Thank you. See you there.
Thank you for the work that you're doing. And this is more of a sort of broad-based comment. It's interesting that you were talking about the fact that the colleges don't see this as a source of enrollment, apprenticeships as a source of enrollment, and the students don't see themselves as students in a sense. And it made me think of the broader challenge for all of us is to think about how in the process of all this innovation, we redefine learning. Because really, truly, I think even those of you who worked in the field, all of us are a little bit locked into what learning is, and learning is changing quickly and dramatically. And I think we have the opportunity as the community colleges of being at the forefront of all this innovation to really think how we redefine who our learners are, and hence who the teachers of those learners are. So Chancellor Christian, if you can get back to us in a week about that, that would be great. But seriously, I do think there's a reframing some of this will really help with those two challenges, and at the broader level, I think it's contingent on us.
Yeah. You know, as I say, in many ways, it's the essence of Vision 2030, right? So the essence of Vision 2030 is how do we help students actually be on a path to get something out of all the time they're committing to be in our colleges? And it can't be just hours. It's important, but it can't be just hours. It has to be credits. It has to be a path to get a certificate, AA, to get eventually a BA degree. That's how we can best serve our students. And last but not least, you know, an apprenticeship will prepare students a whole lot better. And then that's how we support our industries in the state who are crying out for better prepared individuals that can come and work for them. So we need to deliver.
It's sort of like we can say to business, we have the learner for you.
Yeah.
And we can say that to sort of every doctor. We here at community colleges, we have the learner for you because we have every kind of learner there possibly is, and they're motivated and supported.
The other thing I would just note is obviously, Dr. Martinez, you joined us in DC, and policymakers loved this conversation about apprenticeship. And so again, another example of us really, I think, being on the cutting edge here. And I want to thank each of you for helping us figure this out. I really do like this idea of these demonstration projects where we're really getting in, looking under the hood, and then hopefully having the learnings that we can spread system-wide. Because I agree, the funding model is kind of this structural issue that if we can kind of get to that, I think, we can really scale this across the system. So thank you for your partnership there.
Yeah. I want to say, look, politically, this is one of the few issues where both sides of the aisle support. There isn't many today. And there's a lot of, we're just in DC, it's completely polarized out there. But this is one of those areas. And I think we need to milk it as much as we can in order to be for every entity to see our system is that system that will provide answers and produce those students that and train workers that everybody needs.
Great. With that, I'll open it up for any public comment on this item. Oh, sorry, Board Member LeGrand.
I just want a point of clarification. Are the internships paid?
Yeah, the apprenticeships are paid. So in other words, in order for you, because we've done most of them with the trades. So let's say you're an apprentice with a Carpenters Association. You're getting paid. And at the same time, they're training you.
No, that's perfect because I know that population can't afford to have free internships. So that was an issue. So I didn't see it here. So I just wanted to make sure. Thank you.
Thank you. With that, is there any public comment on this item?
The public comment period on item 6.5 is now open. We will begin with public comments in Sacramento. If you're calling in, press *9. You will have 2 minutes. President Costa, we have not received any in-person remarks and no hands are raised.
Great. Thank you so much for the presentation. Appreciate it. We're back into the cloud, colleagues. Our next item is 6.6. We have our expert, Dr. Hayward, who can maybe tell us, I feel like over the river and through the woods. Anyway, next up, we have Vision 23 Common Cloud Data Platform Demonstration Project.
So as Dr. Craig Hayward and President Char Perlis and Rupa Saran, and I think Rebecca initially, go ahead and come forward. Rebecca's first. Oh, Rupa, yeah. So let me make a few comments to open this up. I wanted to start with Board Member Perry's comment about redefining learning, and that was really wonderful. And in Vision 2030, we're trying to grapple with what does the future learner look like and how does every individual, whether they're a worker, have this dual citizenship, both in our community colleges and continuing where they are. And with a partnership with faculty colleagues, I see Cheryl, I see Eric, and I thought I saw Wendy, but I don't see her. Wendy's right over there. I feel a sense that we are going to get into these deeper conversations in redefining what this landscape looks like. So that was one comment. The other one I wanted to key off President Costa's, comment on the demonstration projects in DC. So the demonstration projects is something we at the Chancellor's Office, we're invested in to try this proof of concept. And each project comes with a price tag. So we've been systematic in saying, okay, if we need to do it, what is the price tag? So some of the projects, it's $8 million, $10 million, $6 million, so we're doing that. Then we're working with a foundation, and I'd mentioned this yesterday, but I wanted to reemphasize it, to figure out how do we fund it, through philanthropic dollars. Then we're looking at our own set-asides to see how much can the Chancellor's Office fund. And then wanted to recognize the district. So when Marvin Martinez is coming in with Rancho Santiago, you know, the district itself is also subsidizing the work, which is amazing. So it's like, thank you, thank you, thank you. And the reality is when we're asking the districts, can you subsidize? Can you help? They're saying, yes. I mean, it's an incredible partnership. And so this particular project is the last one in our series of presentations for today. And we'll be bringing back other projects like the Veterans Project at our November meeting is an example of finding resources and everyone kind of committing to make it happen. So the Common Cloud Data Platform Demonstration Project, it's really complex. And what I know is that it's going to evolve as we continue getting deeper into the project. Every step we take, we're going to learn something. And from that learning is going to inform the next step and the trajectory. So the trajectory we are setting today, we know for a fact is going to change because we don't know what we don't know. And the reasons for it, you know, technology is evolving rapidly. Technology is getting smarter and with more capabilities every minute. In addition to that, we know that the governor's office has invested in the concept of cradle to career and signaling all of the different agencies and organizations that we need to get connected if we want California to succeed. So in the cradle to career framework, you've got the UCs and the CSUs. And they're pretty well established with, you know, probably more unified system than the community colleges and K through 12. Community colleges, the systems are at the district level. So the state chancellor's office, and I'm just always wonder, you know, John Hetz does such fantastic work. The idea, however, is we don't have the real-time data. The data is always, it lags behind. So in addition to the educational systems, now we're talking about, you had Stuart Knox here, talking about interagency connectivity. When we're talking about wages, labor agency, we're talking about health and human services. You heard our president saying, we need to bring support to our students. If you're bringing support to the students, we need to be connected with the support systems from health and human services, with our counties and so on. So, you know, we don't know what we don't know, but we do know this, that we have to get the common data structure established now, and we've got to embark on the journey now. So that is a certainty that I feel, but what it looks like, I don't know, but we need to engage in it. So in terms of this particular project, I see Rupa Saran here. I'm deeply grateful to Coast Community College District and Chancellor Whitney Yamamoto, again, partnering with us, subsidizing the work and taking the leadership, and also grateful to President Char Perlis for being here. With that, I'll turn it over to our visiting executive, Dr. Craig Hayward.
Thank you very much, Board President Costa, Vice President Aguinalda, Chancellor Christian, board members. It's our pleasure to connect with you today and talk about the Common Cloud Data Platform. I was reflecting on the conversation yesterday about the Common ERP and the language that we use around data lakes, data clouds, and data flows. And I'm not sure that it's ecologically correct how we do it. We flow the data into a lake and then we float that lake up into the cloud, but those are the metaphors that we use. We're going to also put a little clarification about what the Common Cloud Data Platform Demonstration Project is versus the larger budget requests for the larger project, and how this initial exploration is going to set us up to do some discovery, understand the challenges, benefits, and the return on investment in this direction. So with that, I would like to invite Dr. Perlis, Superintendent President of the College of the Siskiyous, to give us an introduction from the perspective of the CEOs about the benefits and advantages of this project.
Yes, good morning. Thank you for having me. Good morning, Board President, Chancellor Christian, Board of Trustees. So I come to you from College of the Siskiyous, and the Common Cloud Data Platform is, as you can see on the slide, will benefit all colleges in the following ways, but really will benefit mostly the rural small colleges. If you haven't been to my campus, College of the Siskiyous is located in Weed, California. We are in Siskiyou County, which is the size of Maryland, population of 45,000. And we are, College of the Siskiyous is the largest employer of the county. So you can imagine our struggles getting qualified IT specialists. and so not only will the Common Cloud Data platform, you know, help us tremendously as far as resources, but in essence, it is a student equity initiative, right? So in addition to, I just want to pinpoint emphasize two of the main benefits here, and it's resources. So as you know, as I just mentioned, Common Cloud Data Platform will allow small colleges to shift resources that spend a majority of their time fulfilling the central reporting requirements, such as MIS 320 reporting, to institution-specific technology priorities, which would enable us to meet the unique needs of our students. So we have a lot of different platforms that we're working on, and therefore our staff would be able to shift those priorities and really help and move that forward. Also, in regard to systems, the Common Cloud Data Platform would provide an interface that would provide near real-time data to improve student support for all colleges. So those are the two main points that I want to emphasize in this slide. Thank you.
Thank you. And this is a systems project that we're talking about. And so while this may be the last demonstration project that we're talking about this session, it is in no means the least. It is going to enable a lot of the ideas and initiatives and the ability to conduct proactive support and understand our students' progression and journey through our systems at a level that we have not seen before. Next slide, please. Go ahead. Sorry, this is my first time presenting.
Good morning, President Costa, Chancellor Christian, board members. Thank you for having me. And I am so, so excited when Chancellor Christian asked us to participate in partnership with 4CIS. I can't tell you how happy I am. The 4CIS is a consortium, California Community Colleges Consortium for Information Systems. Just a little bit of a background on that. Back in 2018, there were three districts, Foothill De Anza, Kern Community College District, and Coast Community College Districts. The chief information technology officers talked about that, how do we make our system, our districts, better to serve our students. We're doing the similar things 73 different times, 73 different integrations to support our students. Why not come together? We have a common goal to support our students. Why don't we set up some standardizations? How do we benefit from each other? The resources, like President Perles has mentioned about, you know, small districts, they don't have enough IT resources. How do we help each other? So the conversation started and saw the big benefit. Yes, we should be able to help each other and share ideas. So we started those conversations, and more districts were interested. So they started to join. We have those conversations. We still do. We have about 15 districts today. With this demonstration project, we are going to invite 10 4CIS districts to participate and show our chancellor's office as well, that we're doing partnership with chancellor's office, bringing us together. And how do we demonstrate this project? How do we bring in common data so that everyone can take advantage of, ultimately, to support our students? Like Chancellor Kristen has said, We are really happy, and Coast District is going to be a fiscal agent in this particular project. So that's kind of a little bit background on 4CIS. Next slide, please.
Go ahead. So what is the Common Cloud Data Platform Demonstration Project? At its core, it is a single interface for the Chancellor's Office to be able to visualize data, access data across the range of participating districts, which will be up to 10 districts in this initial demonstration project that runs for 2.5 to 3 years. That single interface, we'll get into the benefits of it, but it is going to allow for the sharing of resources, the creation of efficiencies, staff efficiencies in both reporting, analyzing, accessing, and proactively acting on data in ways that we haven't seen before.
Absolutely. And just, you know, again, what is this? What is the background? How do we do this? So just to give a little bit of a background on this, and if we can move forward to next slide. Bottom line is this: what we're talking is big data. How do we innovate? It's data is the key. And why this is making so much sense is we're pulling the data from this participating districts with whatever the solution. This is a solution agnostic. We're not changing any of the solutions right now. The bottom line is pulling the data from our current solution, bringing into Data Lake, that's the central repository, if you will. From there, the dashboard, right, for Chancellor's Office to pull the data, to look at the data, dice and slice, however we need to support our students. How do we see the today's current enrollment? Currently, yes, we do have enrollment data coming to Chancellor's Office, but it's lagging, right? It's not near real-time data. So the part, how we do this is pulling it from our system without making any changes to our current processes, but getting the data out of whether it's our LMS Canvas, whether it's our ERP registration system, our student information system, and bringing it into platform agnostic Data Lake. And from there, that the data is being mapped, standardization, and then having the Chancellor's Office the ability to have the dashboard. So that's kind of in a very high level, but just a little background on that.
Yeah, and just to underscore the importance of this Data Lake being platform agnostic. So that means, although we're currently putting wind in the sails of 4CIS, because that's a field-driven initiative that's been working in this direction for years, and it's gonna give us a leg up and a head start on exploring this direction, that we could potentially expand this concept to really any district. There's no requirement for them to be on a particular platform to participate in this concept, because there's a data extraction translation layer that comes from where your data is and moves it into that standard schema. That's going to be a big part of the work, creating that standardized schema and those translation layers that give us this platform agnostic data lake. And with that, let's move on to the next slide. And we talk about three major areas of impact that we anticipate we can have with the Common Cloud Data Platform. So the efficiencies of scale. Dr. Perlis was talking about the challenges around staffing. It's not unique, really, even to Weed, California, Bakersfield, California. We experience those same challenges. And IT personnel are a hot item in the labor market, and there's a lot of competition for those folks. So there's never enough staffing time to do all the urgent IT things that we need to do. So there are a lot of opportunities for efficiencies of scale to leverage to crowdsource things and leverage the wisdom of the crowd in how we do things efficiently and effectively. Near real-time data, can't overemphasize the exciting benefits of this. This would be a game changer for us in so many ways. We'll get into it in a little bit more detail in the subsequent slides.
Can I ask a question there, Craig? And you may be getting to this, but for the data component, which obviously we at the state level, we like that, we need that. But what about for the districts that are participating? Will it help them with their data visualizations and kind of district level information?
Yes.
Absolutely. The way we want to do this is for both, right? The districts and the chancellor's office. So currently the current process that we have, and I know we have upcoming slides here too, how we submit our MIS data is the running the reports. And really there is almost, depending upon the size of your district, almost one full-time person taking care of that, downloading. And then going through the data efficiency, making sure, you know, the audit, like the quality control, the submission, then if there are errors coming back. So there's a lot of that is happening with this common data platform. Not only Chancellor's Office would have a dashboard, the participating districts would have a similar kind of a dashboard that they also would be able to access.
Yeah, and I think I definitely have some more stories around the COMIS data submission. And I think probably many folks around here could share some. And when you're working on that sort of 73 times, in relative isolation, decisions can be made that aren't necessarily ideal. So, you know, again, making this a community, ensuring that we have good data governance and good quality assurance practices that are shared across all districts, whether they're large or small, would be the vision, sort of the ultimate vision of where the kind of benefits of this could go.
Yeah, I mean, yesterday when I heard about this in the budget conversation, the thing that I was thinking about is like, what's in it for the districts? And so you're starting to explain a little bit about that, but I'd appreciate it if you could expand further, because it sounds like this is a really good thing for them. And we can't require them to do this, or can we? Like, I just wasn't sure like how we're going to get like full kind of participation. I mean, this will be a process, obviously, but it'd be helpful for you all to talk about that a little bit, because that was like the big question I had. Like, well, one, it's expensive, but IT always is, and it's important. But two, like, how are we going to get them to buy into this?
And that is a big question, and I think probably the bottom line is we can look at other successful scaling projects, such as the Common Library System, such as the Common LMS, and learn lessons from how those were effectively scaled. Often it comes down to fiscal benefits and the efficiencies. So there are a lot of benefits. Those need to be communicated. We also need to kind of delineate between this initial demonstration project, which is sort of a first, you know, effort and essay into this direction, and the larger common cloud, common ERP project, which is still in the process of getting organized and finding funding. And Rupa, did you want to speak to that?
No, I mean, you said it all, and especially for districts, right? The resource currently who's spending time for submission for MIS, that could be redirected for strategic work in turn to support our students. So there are a lot of benefits for districts as well. And you're correct, it's not something, it's an initiative that, just like Craig has said, you know, the example would be Canvas. It wasn't forced upon, but as districts start taking in participating in those projects, everyone starts seeing the benefit, and then slowly that kind of continued there too. So absolutely, that there are benefits for our districts as well.
Yeah, so I want to jump in on that a little bit, because this is one of my passion projects that I've had since I've joined the board, I think you all know. And still a little context for it. So years ago, there was the initial discussions on common ERP, right? And the idea was like, everyone should just use the same platform, like, let's just do it. When you take a look at how much time and effort and money it takes to implement a common ERP or just change your individual college's platform, it's a massive multi-year undertaking, right? And so naturally that would have some level of resistance to it. The thing I think is really beautiful about this demonstration project is it really breaks it down in a much simpler way. So rather than a common ERP, you're really setting kind of a foundation for it, right? So the foundation for any platform is going to be, how do you store your data? How do you use your data, right? So what are you looking to get out of a shared data platform? And so what we're doing now, as opposed to what was initially proposed, is having a single place for us to store the data that is usable by us as policymakers, that then whatever platform they are currently using will work with it. And it's really also the same idea between the cradle to career data system, right? Mm-hmm. So the idea here really matches with what we're doing statewide. And it's doing it in a way that is almost kind of harmless in a way. Maybe I'll say that the risk is so much lower for our districts mm-hmm. doing this rather than what was the original ideas were. Mm-hmm. And so now you've got a common data platform. You're learning, how do we store our data? How do we use our data? Well, now you see the benefits of that. You're freeing up the staff time to really be more student focused rather than like every time you have a tech with their hands on technology, it's time that they're not spending with the student. And so creating this platform is going to be wonderful for that. But then I think this will set the groundwork for understanding that, hey, okay, now we're using a common data system. Maybe we should do a common ERP. And as my ERP maybe isn't meeting my needs, and I see this data platform is working well for people with this other enterprise resource platform, well, maybe we'll move to that. But now the transition to it's much easier because we've already done the work. So there's just so many layers to this. It's really a wonderful project.
It's helpful. So it's a phase. We're easing people into this, basically.
Much better than we were going to do originally. Okay. Yes.
So I'm really excited, even though it doesn't sound like I'm really excited. There's a couple of things. One, it's a non-intrusive approach, which then doesn't offend anyone, and it does have benefits. And so I'm going to use my trustee hat at Los Rios, in which that lag time relative to decision-making and not having data in real time is a killer, to be really honest. And I mentioned that yesterday. So this is a really important project. So the question, one of the questions I have is, you have 10 slots for the demonstration project. There are 73 districts. And so what is your thinking around how that, I know you're going to be using the association, the group, so I'm not as familiar with that particular group. Will there be a multi-college district that would be part of the demonstration? My thinking is that there should be one, even though they may indeed have more tech assistance, they're still lagging relative to that. And so a cross-section of the 73 will be very, very helpful in looking at, you know, a year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, what were the different issues relative, what were the successes, but what were the issues relative to that, so that everyone gets a picture, because this is once again, a systems solution to a problem or challenges that we all have. And there's a huge benefit, and I'm going to be very excited about watching the progress. Thank you.
Yeah, so just to clarify and answer your question about will there be multi-college districts, absolutely. And you're absolutely correct. It needs to be, demonstration should be for all sort of colleges, small, rural, multi-single, so we are within those 15 districts, that's how we're kind of inviting the districts with multi as well as small ones. So yes, and definitely lessons learned, like Chancellor Christian has said, as we move forward, we are going to keep, it's a continuous improvement. As we learn, we will improve, we will change and continue.
Okay, back to our slides. I think the near real-time data, I was getting very excited about that when we were last on these slides. And I think we'll talk about it in more detail so we can understand some of the connections to the other projects that have been discussed. But at a minimum, we could understand where our enrollments and headcount are at, you know, today. We could be looking at across, in this case, across the participating districts, what what their enrollments and headcounts look like yesterday. And we can be snapshotting that daily, providing some really cutting edge enrollment management, which is very, very significant at the campus level, because that, again, that's very unevenly distributed across campuses, their ability to do good enrollment management data reporting daily. And I've seen that. So we were hearing, I think that we hear in the wind that we're up double digits, but we would know if we had the system where we were at as a system. Analytics, this is an opportunity to leverage and combine data sources. So student information service systems, our other ad hoc systems, such as Program Pathways Mapper, to better understand progress along programmatic pathways in ways that we haven't. Bringing in Canvas data to understand where students are at in their learning, are they checking into their classes, and leverage student support around those types of data points in a proactive, again, near real-time way. Next slide.
So just a few examples. You know, we talked about MIS and 320. So we wanted to kind of show what it is today. Well, how do we do our process today, and what can be our, how do we envision and how do we improve upon? So really what it is today, it is a one-way submission, if you will. It's point in time. It's not real, near real-time data. And each district has to develop their own quality assurance process, if you will. There is a dedicated person who goes through this process. Errors are common. You upload, you find out there are errors, bring it back, correct them, re-upload. Little visibility there for double checking our quality process within our districts, right? And it is time sensitive, and it is stressful for that individual to take care of that. So that is what we have today. And sometimes there are lags, there are delays. And this is the process that we have in place for our districts today. And what can be?
So what can be is interconnected system that leverages these data flows to show detailed college level, regional, and statewide insights in near real time. We can collaborate across districts and with this near real time integration while maintaining local autonomy. And this is, again, one of those areas where efficiencies would be developed through this collaboration and the wisdom of the crowd. Sharing best practices on quality assurance, agreed upon data governance that gets us the highest quality COMIS data and the highest quality 320 reporting so that colleges are maximizing their funding. This will also free up staff time to work on validating and going deeper into ensuring that the data quality at the campus level and the district level is accurate rather than, you know, gathering up, doing kind of the lower level collation work of gathering up all that information. It puts staff in more in the driver's seat. And this will also deliver actionable insights to the chancellor's office and to each district before that final submission of COMIS or 320. Next slide, please.
And again, I know we touched upon all this before too, but just to quickly run through here for enrollment management, again, what it is today, right? Truly, Chancellor's Office do not have any visibility in current today's enrollment. That is what the issue is. And we as a district, we're responsible to develop some kind of a complex enrollment dashboard. So all of us, again, 73 districts doing differently, accomplishing these tasks and limited share information for our attendance. So how do we improve upon that? And I'll let you talk about what can be.
Yeah, as we've discussed, there are a lot of opportunities to improve enrollment management dashboards, share high quality dashboards, because there's a common data structure. So what works at one district can just be transplanted over to another district, plug and play. That's the beauty of the common cloud data platform concept. This will allow us to maximize our FTS reporting, understand better the opportunities that we have to connect our data as a system in ways to other state systems, cradle to career, apprenticeship, the Department of Apprenticeship Services, DAS, and in ways that we just currently cannot. We cannot do that in real time. That's where that delay really, the COMIS really kind of is hurting us. So all of this will ultimately improve our state policy, our and funding decisions. Next slide.
And again, you know, from analytics perspective, what it is, really, there isn't any standardized system that's set up at the district level that can help our students in completion with ADT, but they didn't do their transfer. How do we spot those students? How do we help them? How do we make them go to, you know, create the path for them for CSUs? So having, not having that is really, we're not helping our students here. And again, districts and chancellor's office, both sides, we're struggling to understand this, our student progression in the program of study and having those aging reports with IT's help. And of course, our institution research office, that's what we have today.
This will enable us to identify ADT completers who are, you know, and position us so that we can collaborate with the CSU to understand, again, in near real time, whether they have been accepted, whether they have applied to the CSU, and then take action as a system to get those students accepted into the CSU as they should be when they complete the ADT. We know that there are thousands of ADT completers who are not accepted into the CSU system. We can't really do much about that unless we can understand that in real time. Because if we wait 9 months to see who completed and do a data, you know, the problem is obvious. Those students will have moved on. We will have lost our window. So that's very exciting. The ability to understand student progression along program pathways and guide course taking to keep students on path. So in real time, checking in to see if their course taking corresponds to their program of study so that they're moving, they're maximizing their momentum and their velocity towards completion and transfer. Very cutting edge, very, you know, the promise of guided pathways fulfilled is a very exciting opportunity. And all of this backed up by the most modern business intelligence being shared across the system and the districts. And then our last slide for our last slide, we're going to be joined by Vice Chancellor Ron Shaughnessy. Thank you. Next slide, please. Thank you.
And most importantly, student support. That's why we're all here, right? So what is it that we have today? Of course, we do have our portals with our college branding on it. But if you look at it, they're pretty much links, right? The links are there for our students to do registration, our faculty members to get their rosters. You know, the screens are all legacy screens. And we all know today's students, they go with their phones. This is how they want to do this. And if you bring in 1980 technology on your phone, it does not work. And that is what we're all struggling with. And then again, having data all over the systems, where some are in our learning management system, Canvas, some are in our ERP registration system, we have early alert. We have all those systems, but they're not integrated. And who is suffering? Our students. So that's what we have. And what can be?
Thank you. Good morning, Vice President Aguinaldo, Chancellor Christian, Board of the Governors members. Very happy to be here. What Rupa described there is very much the data addition of the messy student experience. I think I presented to this board about 2 years ago, right? We have this cafeteria style of programs for students to navigate, right? Behind every single program, there's a portal, link, spreadsheets, right? For students, faculty, and administrators to navigate through, right? So there's clear friction points and clarity impacting our outcome. So when we think about what we can reimagine, right, really in the back end, there's connectivity and access to near real-time data. And on the front end is personalized interface, regardless of the user, right? And then also that translates raw program data information and program speak into actionable insights that all of us can access to provide that holistic support for our students. Next slide, please. So what I'm really saying is let the data flow.
right? Fundamentally, this is about equity, we've heard, right? This is about connectivity. This is about access. And this is all towards learning, institutional learning. We are learning institutions. How do we lean into the expertise and then support our students to learn, right, and succeed? So when we, so I have these kind of like, broadly, there are these really five areas where we see major benefits, right? Holistic view of student experience. I think that's really important, right? So from data program specific things into a whole student, that's fundamental because now we're restoring students' nuanced identity. All the individuals with nuanced identity, we're committed to provide that whole person support rather than this oversimplification of you are a program number and here's the outcome, here's the output, right? And then the second piece around service. So with that, we have to reimagine how we deliver services. When data flows, relationship will have to flow, right? Accountability also flows, right? So now we're looking at how, what kind of services we need to deliver to our students, what kind of coordination, frankly, what kind of automatic enrollment we should do to get students into these programs without them asking for them, because the next one, predictive analytics, is able to get us there. We know who we want to serve. All the programs in legislation have intended, right, population to serve. Now, how do we identify them? Right, there's some program eligibility that we have set up for students to prove. Now we can shift that burden of proof partially through data, right? And if you think about housing, big headache in terms of how labor intensive and capital intensive it is, but we know it's much more effective and cheap, cost effective, if we're able, if nothing is cheap, but cost effective to keep students housed, right? So if there's something we can do to prevent them from losing their current housing arrangement, it's much easier than coming back and to support them when they have already become housing insecure or homeless. So data comes in, right? We are interacting with students daily through various things, right? They are in our institutions. So we are collecting data across the board. How do we leverage the learning data, what's happening in the classroom, to give us early indicators of risk so we can proactively reach out to students and provide the support? And then data-driven strategy and decision-making, I feel like that's the theme of this demonstration project, right? But now we can actually live it because we have near real-time data to make those decisions. And then also, I think it speaks to the new level of engagement partnership with system, between systems and districts. When we are asking for reports, they are 9 months old, right? In terms of data, the default is compliance because it's like, what have you done and have you done well? And I know in previous system webinars, we have always said compliance is important, but learning and continuous improvement is way more important, right? So having this, having real-time data, having access, then that enables us to collectively learn and mutually learn from one another. I think that's going to be a game changer for the system. So in summary, right, it's not just about user experience, right? It's not just about analytics and insight, but it fundamentally have to shifts how we view our roles and responsibility in terms of serving students in our system, right? And then also our commitment to really own student performance, student experience, and student outcome, really live to the equity and support success, right? And access commitments that we have made.
Thank you. Next slide.
So just the implementation piece of it, the way we're going to proceed with this demonstration project is having three staff positions, and of course, close partnership with Chancellor's office. So now we're truly, it's like Rebecca has said, you know, system and districts, we're working together. It's also district-driven initiative. So this is the true partnership. And the timeline we're looking for is starting now, if we move forward with this, the fall 23 through our June of 26. So it's about 2.5 years, but we want to have that moving fast, like Chancellor's Christians love the sentence of our time is now. So we must act now and support our students.
Yes, our time is now and let the data flow. Those are our rallying cries With that, we will end our presentation and invite any, happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much. I'm going to do a quick time check on us because we have about 58 minutes left to cover at least three items, two of which are particularly meaty. So with that disclaimer, I'd like to open it up to my colleagues to see if there are any questions. Member Rawlings.
Not so much a question, but comment. I think this is incredibly important. There was a point that Dr. Christian made earlier today about we don't know what we don't know, right? And one of the potentials for this common data platform is that we have a larger pool of data to analyze. And when you have that, you can then kind of do the deeper analytics, as Rebecca Ron O'Shaughnessy had commented on. You can do this deeper analysis and you can identify patterns better. And so you can end up learning what you don't know. And so you identify correlations that then you can investigate for causation and really do some of this deeper learning on what student success looks like and how do you address some of the equity issues we have. Some colleges and some programs may be doing it well, and we just don't understand it because we don't have the data and we don't have a way to do comparative analytics to it, right? So that is really important. And part of the reason that it's so important is that our students don't have time to wait, right? If we are taking 9 months to a year to make a policy decision on something we can make today, that is a year our students do not have to wait. And so the urgency here is very much appreciated. So I'm looking forward to seeing the future reports on this. And as we expand this, hopefully that happens fairly quickly.
Okay, any other board comments? Seeing none, we'll move to public comment.
The public comment period, item 6.6 is now open. We will begin with public comments in Sacramento. If you're calling in, press star 9. You'll have 2 minutes. Vice President Aguinaldo, we have not received any in-person remarks and no hands are raised.
Wonderful. Let's make a smooth transition to the next item, 6.3, Vision 2030, Goals, Outcomes, and Metrics. The next item belongs to Dr. Christian, Dr. Hetz, and Dr. Lowe.
With the time constraint, I'm not going to do my introductory remarks. I'll turn it over to Dr. Hetz.
All right. Vice President Aguinaldo, Chancellor Christian, members of the board and the public. Yesterday, I think all of us saw us launch an audacious and bold vision for the future, not just of our system, but of the entire state of California. And what we have done is we have charted a course towards where we want to be in 7 years and well beyond that. I tend to use lots of different metaphors. And I was, set out to use a metaphor here about how we think about roadmaps and things like that. But I don't think that captures the excitement. I don't know if you guys could feel it today, but that kind of frisson, that sudden kind of onset, I heard so many of you talking about how excited we are. I think it's more rather than a map, it's more of a symphony, right? What we have is a bunch of virtuoso instruments that are going to be delivering really new, exciting changes for our students in the classroom. We have all these complex interleaved harmonies that will capture and support our students and make sure they complete. My part, unfortunately, is the slightly less exciting part. I'm in the rhythm section. I help us know whether or not we keep us on time, keep going forward, making sure that we are making the progress we hope to. So I hope you can hold all that excitement that we've been talking about and keep it on track for how we're going to keep track of how we're going. So if we could go back to the slide deck. All right. First thing, if we could go to the next slide. All right. So one of the key things here, to follow on the symphony metaphor, if you will, the leitmotif of this symphony is equity, right? The core thing that we are going to continue to lead with as we have over the course of the vision success is to make sure that first and foremost, Vision 2030 keeps our goals for equity front and center for all of our students. And you can see it's built into the document very powerfully. It's built into all of the goals, because every student deserves the supportive platform for them to succeed. Next slide. So this is going to continue to be our North Star. It's our guide to the future. even when the path is challenging, especially when the path is challenging. I think we've talked about what those challenges are. We have wrestled with trying to close equity gaps in our system for some time, and we have a long way to go. Keeping that at the center of this work is pivotally important, right? Equity recognizes that each student has different circumstances, and it strives to provide them the exact resources and opportunities needed for them to reach their goals, right? And to be successful after they have come to our institutions. Next slide. So the overarching principle here is to ensure that the academic and life success of all who attend a community college, right? That's the core of equity of success. So the first, what we're trying to do is make sure that we are going to track and improve the outcomes of underrepresented students of color, low-income students, students with disabilities, to the current average on each outcome. So there's a couple of key things that are new there, right? So one is on each outcome. In previous instantiations of the vision, we focus primarily on completion for all of our disaggregation and equity work. We are going to be doing that work on every single one of the outcomes that you're going to see today. Additionally, one of the things that we're going to be doing, one of the things that's happening within the main document, the work that we'll be doing over time, we've aligned this with the governor's roadmap with our system so that we are going to be specifically doing disaggregations for the groups mentioned, but all of our current equity groups will continue to be part of our student equity plan, will be on all of our state board dashboards, and Chancellor Christian has prioritized us working with our research unit to make sure that we are engaging supplemental work around our statewide reports to make sure that we do deeper disaggregations of our different race and ethnic groups, because they are highly complex and there's a lot of differences that are happening within the larger categories that we spend our time with together. So there will be additional supplemental reports that we will be providing after each instantiation of the statewide report. Next slide. Okay, so equity and success. This is going to be a familiar goal for all of you. This was vision goal number one. We are going to continue to look at and improve the outcomes of students in our system. We're looking at the number of students who complete a meaningful education outcome or certificate, a degree, a bachelor's degree in one of our programs. And the benchmark goal here is to increase that by 30% over the next 7 years. Next slide. So this is an outgrowth of some of the conversations that we have been having. And so thinking very carefully about the broader picture. Previously, our second vision goal was transfer. We are thinking much more broadly about that now to center that on baccalaureate attainment. And to do that, that's going to take some work for us as a system. So you'll notice here that goal 2A does not have a determined benchmark. So as Chancellor Christian has mentioned, as many of my colleagues have mentioned, this is a living document. So we are in the process of building the internal systems. We have got memorandums of understanding with the CSU and the UC to be able to bring their information much more reliably into our system so that we can track the outcomes of our students all the way to their baccalaureate degree if that's what they're choosing to get. So we are still in the process of ingesting all that data, so I cannot give you a benchmark for that yet. That will be part of this being a living document, so we'll talk more about that in January. Fingers crossed. But some of the other benchmarks are going to be very familiar to you. So for goal 2B, we're going to increase the number of California Community College students who earn an associate degree for transfer. Now, you've seen this before, but not as a vision goal, right? So this was something that we always provided and talked about as context. We are now incorporating that directly into the outcomes that we are tracking, and we will be reporting back to you. If we could go to the next slide, please. Goal 2C. This is also a new goal. It's a very appropriate goal for where we are as a system, and that is increasing the number of our students who earn a community college bachelor's degree. We have a growing number of bachelor's degree programs in our system. We're going to set a goal for us to continue to increase the number of graduates that we have with bachelor's degrees when we leave our system by 30%. And then goal 2D, all of you should recognize that was our old Vision 2 goal. That's just increasing the number of students who transfer to UC or CSU. There's two different benchmarks here. One of the things that Executive Vice Chancellor Navarette worked with when we set up the governor's roadmap is for us to set an achievable benchmark based on enrollment spots that are available at our partners. And so the baseline benchmark that we are going to work towards is to increase the number of students who transfer in a way that's consistent with the enrollment growth of those systems. If those systems are shrinking, that means that there are not necessarily more spots for our students. the stretch benchmark, of course, Executive Vice Chancellor Lowe will be leading a lot of this work, is to actually build better intersegmental cooperation and collaboration so that collectively, working together hand in hand with our colleagues, we can actually move more students directly into the CSU. And you heard a little bit about that in the previous project. You heard a lot about the work that we're doing as a system yesterday. And Vice Chancellor Lowe will talk about, the Executive Vice Chancellor Lowe will talk a little bit more about that in a second. But if we can get that cooperation, we can actually dramatically improve transfer. If we could go to the last slide on equity and success. And the last thing that we are also going to have to build out, right now we don't have all the different identification for all the different hundreds of institutions that our students do transfer to. So we're going to build out the mechanism to be able to separate out the private, independent, nonprofit institutions and track transfer to those as well. So that's another one that we're going to have to wait to talk a little bit more to you in January. So Dr. Lim.
Thank you, Dr. Hetz. Just adding Board of Governors to achieve our goals around 2D and 2E with our intersegmental partners, both UC, CSU, as well as our independent colleges and universities, that intersegmental collaboration is going to be so essential. So when you think about this goal, think of our time yesterday talking about how we're going to leverage Common Course numbering, talking about the work of AB 928, other work that is underway, like the implementation of CalGETC, the implementation of dual admissions, and this important work that we are already beginning to work in collaboration with the Academic Senate on developing pathways across the segments. That is a new frontier for our state. We have not done that, right? We've made some important progress with CSU specifically. There is an infrastructure that exists for us to leverage and to build on, but to further expand that work with UC, with our private partners, is really going to be pioneering work for our system and is going to be really important to us meeting these goals.
All right, thank you. If we could go to the next slide. So this is the next slide. One of the things we are moving into are the metrics that we are tracking as a system level. We've had this in our metrics for a very long time, but we are moving this up in priority and visibility. And that is to really emphasize what happens to our students after they graduate from our system. I've heard lots of people, both speakers and many of you, talk about the pivotal importance that our students come to try and leave with a meaningful job that can support their family when they leave. And so one of the things, if that's really a core to what we want to do, we need to track it, right? We need to pay attention to that. And so one of the things we'll be doing is tracking and seeking to increase the number of California Community College students who earn a living wage. It'll be originally centered, right? Because the living wage is very different across the different regions of California and will be updated annually for inflation, all those types of things. Anyone who wants to have that conversation with me, we can do an hour afterwards. We're short on time. If we could go to the next slide. Another important thing that we're going to build into Vision 2030 is really thinking more carefully about opening doors. And you've heard a lot about that. You've heard about the work that we're doing in dual enrollment. You've heard about the work we're doing with UDW. You've heard about all of these opportunities that we are using to take education to the students of California, to people who weren't students in California, and help them become students. And so our goal here is essentially to restore and grow the enrollments of our system. So by 2030, to increase the number of Californians attending the California Community College by 25%, and notably for populations that's had declines that were greater than 25%, our goal is to get them at least back to where they were prior to the pandemic. Next slide. Equity and support. There are two key metrics here. One of the things, just that kind of an overarching principle here. We went back. The goal here is to partner with other systems. And so you've heard conversations about that, right? That to bring in information from other systems, other agencies, other institutions, community-based organizations, so that we can better support students from the moment that we start to connect with them, right? One of the things I just want to alert you to here for these metrics are indicators. They are not measures of that support, right? Because measuring that support is far more complex. It often involves lots of narrative. What we are doing is going to look at a couple of things that, if we are getting students the support that we need, if we are reframing and making our programs work more efficiently, we should get these indicators to change. So if I could go to the next slide with the actual indicators. So there are two. One of them is to maximize the financial aid that students receive to increase the number of students that receive state and federal aid. You've heard people talk about there's a lot of money that we leave on the table for our students. We have to do a better job of institutions of bringing that money into our communities, to our institutions, and into our students' pockets. So our goal by 2030 is to increase the number of students who are receiving Pell and the California, it's the College Promise Grant. The two C's always throws me. And then the second thing is, and you should be familiar with this, this is a continuation of one of our previous vision goals as well, and that is if we can continue to do this more successfully, bring students, bring information in with students, make sure they're getting credit for prior learning, making sure that their units are transferring, that we can get them to finish much more quickly. So we're going to continue to seek to reduce the number of units that it takes for students to earn one of our degrees. And so I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Lowe to talk a little bit about these efforts.
Thank you very much. So when we think about these goals, in particular goal six around decreasing unit accumulation, we're now talking about the combination of our work, right, under equity and success for the intersegmental coordination that will be essential, but then connecting that with all that you heard today, right, the partnerships that will be developed for us to focus on eliminating barriers and streamlining processes for students, really operating with an ideology or a concept of universal design for comprehensive wraparound supports. So think about additional partnerships that will be coming down the pipe with community-based organizations, offices like Health and Human Services, county resources, because we know that so often what derails our students is about life, right? It's about things like childcare and transportation and things of that nature. You heard today some of the demonstration projects that will help us to meet this goal. It's about having an opportunity to be in a paid apprenticeship while you are also engaging in upskilling and reskilling. So it all comes together in some ways. And I think it'll really show up as we make progress on this goal number six, that all of these pieces, equity and support, equity and access, equity and success will come together to help us to meet this very important goal. Continuing also with that, the academic support specifically. And that's going to be really important for this work. When we think about support, it's not thinking of that in a siloed ways, right, as support programs for students, but also thinking about academic supports being a part of that. So proliferating flexible schedules, flexible modalities, and also offering these relevant workforce aligned programs are all a part of what will help us to achieve these goals.
All right. If you'll forgive me one just last flight of fancy. At the end of one of my favorite films, one of the main characters sets out on a journey based on a calculated risk, but with a very well-developed plan to seize his future. And as he gets on this bus to ride into his future, he says something that I think captures the way that I feel. I think the way that I've seen a lot of people feel. I am so excited about this path forward that I find I can barely sit still or keep a thought in my head. This is in the, you know, so like member Villalobos, I don't have like a high emotional range. So this is a really like tippy top. I am super excited. I think it's the excitement that people feel at the beginning of a long journey whose future is not necessarily certain, right? And that is going to be at times challenging, but incredibly important and meaningful for all of us and for the people of California. And so I hope all of you can feel some of that excitement as well, even though we're talking about the data right now. So so with that, I open the floor to any questions that you might have about the measure.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hetz and Dr. Lowe. Mindful of the time again. Do my colleagues on the board have any comments? Member Epstein.
Okay, well, I've got a few questions that could be somewhat annoying. This has been a pet issue of mine, the reducing units to completion. Mm-hmm. In the agenda item that we're looking at right now, it said the goal is to reduce the number of units by 10%. But in the document we looked at yesterday, the vision 2030 document, it said 20%.
Yes. So that is one of the, as a living document, those changes continue to happen. As you saw in my PowerPoint, it said 20% and it is 20% okay. in the Vision 2030 goals.
I hadn't thought about this before. I just read this now, but I think the benchmarks are pretty aggressive and appropriate. The one that I was just thinking about as we were talking is the one who's got a CCC baccalaureate, because we're starting with a very low number, right?
We are,
and it's the same 30% that is based on much higher numbers for the other metrics. I mean, do you think that might need to be adjusted at some point? Because, we're adding, 10 programs every 6 months or whatever it is. And so anyway, that's just one I'd look at, because that seems to me like, I don't know how many baccalaureates we've given out so far that are per year, but a 30% increase probably isn't that much given the number of new programs that are.
Of all the goals, that one is likely to be the most achievable.
Yeah.
but it also does continue to depend on us maintaining the goodwill and collaboration and cooperation, right? Yeah. So if we want to continue to grow by 10 per cycle, we have actually have to make that work. Right. So there's a lot of, I think that there's the largest upside for that goal, mm-hmm. but there's a pretty big confidence interval depending on whether or not we can secure the cooperation with our colleagues.
Okay. And then there's just the other one. I was just curious about these, independent colleges and universities. And we have ADTs yes. with Western Governors, with the HBCUs. You don't have to have this now, but at some point I'd like to see what is our baseline that we are know about. I know we don't know about all the independent colleges because we can't track that, but at least do we have that data for just those two that we've given ADTs to?
Yeah, so we're actually working on a project right now to get that data from all of our MOU partners. So we're working on a project in partnership with the foundation to collect that data. It is a part of the MOU, it's a part of the contract. And so we're utilizing some additional bandwidth from the foundation to collect that data from those MOU partners and to assess it, right? To understand what are the outcomes of our students at those institutions? How are the MOUs with those institutions helping students to transfer? So that's an item that we look forward to bringing to the board once we have that data analysis. I would anticipate later in spring.
Okay, thank you.
Seeing no other comment for the board, we're going to go to public comments.
The public comment period on item 6.3 is now open. We will begin with public comments in Sacramento. If you are calling in, press *9. You'll have 2 minutes. I will hand it over to Vice President Aguinaldo to begin with public remarks in Sacramento.
Thank you. We just have one public comment on this item from Larry Galizio.
Good afternoon, Larry Galizio, League. So if John Hetz is the rhythm section, I'm going to do a little Jimi Hendrix feedback. With all the great things that have been said about the vision and the goals, I wanted to offer some feedback because, conspicuously absent from this board is a position for a CEO at local districts. People like a Marvin Martinez or Carol Goldsmith. So, stretch goals, for example, are very difficult to reach, and especially if you're in a straitjacket. And we have in this state a law from 1961 that if you talk to any CEO, they will say, yes, we need more resources to support our students, to advance our equity goals. But they would also say, you know what? Take this straitjacket off from 6 decades ago and allow me to make decisions based upon the evidence, the needs of the students, and the needs of the communities. And I know you'd understand that I'm talking about the 50% law, and I know this board cannot make that change, but I'm asking this board, and I hope it's not until 2030 that this happens, if we can't take off this straitjacket or you can't help us convince legislators and the governor's office that these constraints are so illogical and that they need to be changed. you know, in 6 decades, you can gain weight or you can, your body can change. You need to let off, you know, at least let out some of the straitjacket and make changes, because the way it is right now, and I'm going to continue this in the public forum. So sorry, Wendy. I'm too verbose, but the non-instructional work that's needed to help our students, simply, we cannot make the expenditures needed with this straitjacket that we have.
That is time. Thank you.
Member Brown.
Thank you. I have one comment and one question. So for the goal 5, maximizing financial aid, I would hope that we have a stretch goal that all students receive all aid that they're eligible to receive. And the other thing is, I think there's a connection between this and those students who receive their ADTs and don't continue. There needs to be some education about financing your education beyond the community college. I think a lot of students don't realize how much more aid they will get when they transfer. So that's a huge issue. The other, the question I have is for slide 9, goal 2E. I'm wondering, does that include our out-of-state colleges? I'm thinking about the students that are transferring to the HBCUs, especially in really high demand majors where I've seen students apply to 4 Cal States and get rejected from all 4, but that same major at an HBCU or one of our an out-of-state college, there's no issue at all for those students to get admitted. So I'm wondering, are we including that data in that particular metric for out-of-state? Thank you.
So as a quick answer to that, absolutely, we are planning, we already collect information about transfer. What we are working to do, as Dr. Lowe mentioned, is build better data sharing agreements with some of those institutions, because we can't necessarily easily track whether or not they complete afterwards. We can track very easily whether they go someplace else, but not necessarily whether or not they complete. So we absolutely will be tracking transfer to those institutions that they are included in the nonprofits and independents. We will be tracking and send benchmarks for that. The question that we have to work through is, how do we better develop the data arrangements to be able to track those students to completion at those institutions?
Sure. Vice President Aguinaldo, there are no hands raised.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. With that, let's move on to our next item, 6.2, 2023 Legislative Session Overview and Impacts to Community Colleges. And that item belongs to Vice Chancellor O'Brien.
Thank you. Good morning, board members. Wait for my slides to come up. Perfect. Thank you. Good morning, David O'Brien, Vice Chancellor for Government Relations. And we're pleased to present somewhat different update than we usually present, because we are at the stage where the legislature has now adjourned for the first year of the 2-year session. And so we are starting to look back at the many bills of substance and impact that were made their way through the legislature this year, and what that will mean for our system and our students going forward, and starting to do that linkage that we spoke about yesterday in my presentation with Dr. Navarette to Vision 2030. And how we can continue to align our legislative priorities to our forthcoming vision. So we can go to the next slide, please. So this is just the recap of the sort of main, the big top line numbers that set the context for this discussion, but a total of just over 3,000 bills were considered by the Assembly and Senate in the first year of this 2-year session. And keep in mind, there will be a lot more next year as well. Following the bill introduction deadline in February, my team identified a total of 214 bills with an impact to higher education, of which 82 were classified as what we call Tier 1, which are those that are considered to have the most impact to our system, our students, and to our priorities. Over the course of the year, legislature passed a total of 1,329 bills and resolutions before adjourning on September 14th. Some of them have already been signed by the governor. Of those we identified, we ended up with a total of 37, basically 37 Tier 1 bills made it to the governor's desk. And there are significant impacts to those that we want to talk about. The governor has until October 14th to sign or veto all legislation at that point. Of course, fun fact is, I always like noting to people, just a little sort of quirk of the process, is that anything he doesn't take action on by midnight on October 14th automatically becomes law without his signature. Next slide, please. So as you may recall, board members, stemming from last year's system budget and legislative requests, so if I'm getting my years aligned right, that was the 2023-24 system request, the board approved three pieces of sponsored legislation for the chancellor's office to move forward with that would have expanded educational opportunities for undocumented students, modernized our workforce and career education programs, and ensured parity and compensation for our Board of Governors student members. Regrettably, and this is a theme that applied across the board due to the legislative year and the fact that there were a lot of bills that were trimmed down or did not make it out of the appropriations committees this year. Regrettably, two of them were held. Assembly Bill 680 by Assemblymember Blanca Rubio would have automatically qualified undocumented students and other eligible students for AB 540 status after they earned an ADT or 60 transferable units. This bill was held in the Assembly Appropriations Suspense File in May. And Assembly Bill 1370 would have modernized the Economic and Workforce Development Program and unfortunately was held in Senate Appropriations Suspense in August. The good news, though, the author on that one being Assemblymember Tree Ta, I want to thank our authors for their support as well as our large coalition of co-sponsors and supporters, which included the Student Senate on all three of these. We were really pleased to see. The good news is that Assembly Bill 1542, creating a process for Board of Governors student members to receive equitable compensation for their service, that was actually folded into the state budget. So the bill didn't even need to advance. And really want to thank Assemblymember Mike Fong, the chair of the Assembly Higher Education Committee, for his leadership on that, as well as, of course, both Board Member Medina and his predecessors as student members of this board for being very vocal in the need to ensure that student members of the Board of Governors are compensated for their service. Next slide, please. Another thing you may recall that you'll be seeing again this upcoming January is this past January, the board reviewed our legislative principles, and what we did this year, we'll be doing something similar but modified, I anticipate in January, is really align them to the five goals of the governor's roadmap for the future. And so we looked for legislation that sought to advance those goals or aligned with those goals. I think we'll be doing something very similar again, spoiler alert, with Vision 2030 and looking to see, you know, how legislation in the upcoming session aligns to our goals and strategic directions within the vision. Overall, we ended up with a support position on 11 bills on the governor's desk and a support if amended position on one bill. Just a few I want to highlight that aren't noted on the slide here are significant. Senate Bill 467 by Senator Portantino removes employment barriers for undocumented students seeking to enter nursing and allied health programs. That's already been signed by the governor actually earlier this summer. And we want to thank FAC for leading this effort. This is an important bill that will help a lot of our undocumented and Dreamer students actually enter the workforce after graduating from one of our programs. Assembly Bill 358 by Assemblymember Don Addis removes barriers to construction of student housing projects by clarifying that community college student housing projects are exempted from the requirements of what's commonly called the Field Act or the requirement to undergo review by the Division of the State Architect. And then finally, Assembly Bill 1541 by Assemblymember Mike Fong increases representation for local student trustees by ensuring that all local boards of trustees provide their student with at least an advisory vote on measures coming before the board. And want to thank SSCCC for leading that effort. That was one that, again, students had been really vocal about for a long time and finally got that across the finish line this year. Next slide, please. Again, as I noted earlier with regards to some of our sponsored bills, due to the state's fiscal situation and the uncertainty in the economy, the legislature took a very, very high level of scrutiny towards bills with a significant fiscal impact this year. These are just a few of the many, many bills that were held. It's called held on suspense or held in committee in the appropriations committees due to concerns about costs or were amended significantly due to concerns about costs. Heading into the final round of appropriations committee hearings just a couple of weeks ago, our team estimated that the tier one bills that we were tracking that were still alive alone, just the tier one bills, would have posed somewhere in the neighborhood of $400 million in ongoing costs to the system to implement. So it is important to have those discussions during times of revenue shortfall, that it's not just the budget that creates costs, cost pressures for the state, it's legislation. And the legislature, like I said, applied a little extra scrutiny, and we are anticipating that the governor may do so as well with his veto pen this year. Even the remaining tier one bills that are alive and made it to the governor's desk are likely to result in costs of somewhere around $100 million one time and ongoing to our system if they're signed into law. Next slide, please. Just want to close with a brief recap on a few bills that are most likely to significantly impact our colleges and our students. But I want to note that by the time of the next board meeting, we will have released our annual chapter legislation report, which is coming out in a new expanded edition this year. Pleased to announce that we'll document that contain summaries of all of these bills, as well as additional context and guidance for how they are to be implemented by the field. Assembly Bill 368 makes several changes, mostly technical changes intended to expand dual enrollment opportunities for underrepresented students. That's authored by Assemblymember Chris Holden, for those who don't know, is essentially the godfather of dual enrollment in the legislature, and someone we're hoping to work with next year on our legislation around breaking down barriers to dual enrollment. Assembly Bill 811 by Assemblymember Mike Fong has to do with credit course repetition, specifically clarifying that students who have already received a satisfactory grade in specific courses in arts, humanities, foreign language, or ESL must be allowed to repeat the course a second time, but no more. You may have heard me discuss this bill at prior meetings of the board. We had some concerns about the direction of the bill, but want to work with the assembly member and the sponsors on ensuring that that their concerns are reflected as well. Assembly Bill 1291 was a somewhat late-breaking bill towards the end of the session in response to the issue of the UC system not participating in the ADT pathway. And what this bill does is it creates a pilot requiring the UCLA to participate and requiring UC to designate at least five of their campuses and at least to participate in selected majors and pathways from community colleges that they select. If it sounds convoluted, it is a little bit convoluted. But again, we've been working on this issue and talking about this for many years about making progress towards the UC system participating in the ADT. Next slide, please. Few more I want to highlight. I got a couple more slides relating to affordability and basic needs. Assembly Bill 607 has to do with the cost of course materials and requiring our colleges to display the estimated costs of all required course materials for at least 75% of the total number of courses on the online campus schedule. We supported this due to our belief in, you know, transparency around the total cost of success for our students. Assembly Bill 789 by Assemblymember Berman requires policies around what's called satisfactory academic progress to be largely aligned to federal standards. And then Assemblymember 1540 by Assemblymember Fong requires that students' eligibility for Assembly Bill 540 status, AB 540 status, that the college accept an affidavit provided to the Student Aid Commission, with the idea being that a lot of that work of and burden of verifying students should be taken off of the institution and, whenever possible, off the student. We're hoping to actually work with CSAC on incorporating that affidavit into the California DREAM Act application itself, so that students only have to verify their AB 540 eligibility once, not twice, and can just do it through the application. Next slide. This is the last one on state legislation. A few bills I wanted to note that I really won't focus on having to do with local policies, collective bargaining, which, as you know, is an issue that the chancellor's office generally does not weigh in on a legislative sense with official positions out of deference to the local collective bargaining process. But Assembly Bill 1699 is a bill that's gotten a lot of attention on some of our listservs lately, requiring vacancies for classified positions to be offered with priority to current classified employees. Senate Bill 444, sponsored by our MESA program directors, represented by FAC, encourages colleges to create MESA programs and set certain standards at the statewide level and requirements to the Board of Governors to set those standards through regulations. And then finally, one you may have heard about relates to the travel ban, the much discussed state travel ban on travel to states that are determined to have discriminatory policies towards the LGBTQ community. Earlier this year, there was a lot of discussion among legislative leaders and the governor about whether that effort, which started about 10 or so years ago, a little less, had been successful. As that list started to grow and grow, and it turned out that there were a lot of conferences and events in other states that we were not allowed to travel to, and then any district in particular using state funds could not participate in as well. And so legislative leaders and the governor reached agreement on a compromise. Oh, the other thing I want to highlight is HBCUs. A lot of students were noting they could not participate in state-funded tours of HBCUs in other states if they were on that list.
the governor reached compromise with legislative leaders where they are repealing those provisions, and that has actually already taken effect. The bill had an urgency clause, and instead directing state funds toward an educational campaign in those states about the effect of discriminatory laws. All right, next slide. And I don't want to take too much of the chancellor's thunder from her great update yesterday, but just wanted to again highlight that last week, several of us had the opportunity to visit Washington, D.C., both visit congressional leaders on Capitol Hill, as well as some key federal agencies that we have not often had the opportunity to meet with and work with, the Departments of Energy, Education, Commerce, and Labor. And many of those were about the demonstration projects that you just heard about. And I can echo the chancellor's sentiments in noting that there was a lot of excitement. Just my personal observation has been that sometimes in previous federal advocacy trips, it's been a process where, you know, we walk in, we hand them the materials, we sort of recite our priorities, and we get a response that's mostly just, oh, thank you for being here, I'll pass this along, great to meet you, take a picture, and leave. In this one, most of our meetings ran over time. There was just a lot of excitement, a lot of folks bouncing off each other. I think the Biden administration officials are really, really appreciative of the innovative work that's being led here and of the chancellor's vision. And so my favorite picture there is Chancellor Christian posing with the sign for a new office at the Department of Energy. This is a new office, the Office of State and Community Energy Programs. And they were just so, so thrilled to be able to hear about the work we want to lead around climate and clean energy and to partner with us. All right, next slide for the less sort of fun news. Our second speaker of the House from the state of California in a row there. As you know, the division in Congress means that we are likely headed towards a shutdown of the federal government. The Republican-led House cannot reach agreement with the Senate or the administration on continued spending for the federal government. There's a very small minority of 5 to 10 members of the Republican caucus in the House who seem to not want to reach agreement on any sort of funding of federal government agencies at all. It kind of seems, to be honest with you, like they would prefer that those agencies just never be funded. So I guess, thankfully, the federal agencies all have what's called shutdown procedures and binders from previous shutdowns that they're now opening up and getting ready for. The Department of Education, for instance, has indicated that they may have to furlough up to 90% of their employees. Generally speaking, there has not been significant impacts to financial aid disbursements, other forms of student aid or research or grant funding when there have been federal shutdowns. However, one of the things we are monitoring are the student loan repayment options and, forgiveness and on-ramps that the Biden administration has prepared. It is truthfully unclear whether those can continue to function during a federal government shutdown. So we will be monitoring that. Next slide, please. And then, unfortunately, a piece of news that we've had to bring to you multiple times is that a federal judge in Texas ruled that the updated regulations that the Biden administration's Department of Homeland Security promulgated around DACA has ruled again that those are unlawful, that they circumvent Congress's authority to pass legislation. So as with previous similar rulings, these did not roll back the DACA program or affect current beneficiaries, but it does, sort of put the ball back in the hands of Congress. And that was always, as always, is a key piece of our federal advocacy, is urging Congress to just take action to protect our DACA students and dreamers so that we don't have to continue bringing these updates to you on these court rulings. That concludes my update. I'm happy to take any questions.
Thanks, colleagues. Any questions or comments for Vice Chancellor O'Brien? You covered it all. With that, is there any public comments on this item?
The public comment period on item 6.2 is now open. I will hand it over to Vice President Aguinaldo to begin with public remarks in Sacramento.
Thank you. We just have one public comment on this item, and it's from Wendy Brill Wankoop.
I hope I'm not the only thing between you guys and lunch, because that would be a hard place to be. Anyway, good morning, President Costa, Vice President Aguinaldo, Chancellor Christian, and members of the Board of Governors. I'm Wendy Brill Wankoop, President of the Faculty Association of California Community Colleges. I am here to highlight the success of FACT's sponsored legislation, SB 467, which you heard earlier in SB 444. But I want to break from script for a minute because I am just giddy. I was listening. I wasn't in the room, but I was listening on Zoom to the demonstration projects. And it is so wonderful to hear that we're committed to partnering with unions. I've been a lifelong union member, and our unions and our straight are strong, and union members make more money and have better jobs. So yes, yes, yes. So excited. Back on script. So FAC is proud to support our students with the signing of SB 467. The bill removes barriers for students who use an ITIN number entering programs that ensure that they're not denied admission to community college apprenticeship or internship training programs because they use that ITIN number. This has been signed by the governor and it is law, and we were happy to be able to be part of it. We're also hopeful that SB 444, which would codify MESA programs that allow for our students that need those extra support in STEM programs to have it. I also just want to mention very quickly about the 50% law. As we have conversations about modifying the 50% law, I hope that we are committed as a system that our students deserve full-time faculty, that our students deserve diverse faculty, and that our students deserve smaller class sizes. That's one of the reasons the 50% law was put in place, and I hope that we can be committed to that. So thank you very much.
Thanks for your comments. Any online comments on this item?
President Costa, there are no hands raised at this time.
Okay, next we move to item 6.7, which is board member reports. I see board member.
I'm going to only take 1 minute, I swear. I was at the DIA conference in San Diego, fully subscribed in the first day. Everyone is excited. But I'm also excited about our team. I had an opportunity. They came on stage and each one of them shared their own personal story of why it's important for them to do this work. We know it is because we see such good work, but Lizette, John Hetz, Aisha, Daisy, John Stankus, Bull, Rebecca, David, Sandra, I might be missing somebody. They were all there. And for the audience of all of our faculty and staff who do this work, I think it was really important for them to see the stellar expertise and commitment and advocacy from that team. And so I just want to say thank you.
Thank you, Vice President Aguinaldo.
Thank you very much. Board Member Perry and I had the opportunity to speak before the advisory board of the Nazarian School of Business at California State University, Northridge or CSUN. And we had a wonderful conversation with the folks on the advisory board talking about everything from dual enrollment, which we understand has a dual meaning for enrollment with community college students and the CSU system. So I hope somebody goes ahead and clarifies that terminology there, but also things like the data lake and the importance of exchanging information with our sister systems as well. So thank you very much to Member Perry, who added just another level of expertise and grace to the conversation, as well as the executive in residence and strategic advisor, Wendy Gruel, who really helped to facilitate the conference with the board.
Just a couple of comments. One, I just want to echo the comments that were made earlier about the ribbon cutting at Santa Rosa Junior College with Member Medina and Haynes, myself, and I think it was Bill was the other person that was there. I just want to say how excited the trustees that were at that college were to see the Board of Governors there. And so I think that that interaction between us is really an important thing to continue to have. And so I was really grateful for the opportunity to do that. And the second thing is just a thank you. I just want to echo the dedication of the team here at the Chancellor's office. I had to participate in a Sunday 2030 vision meeting. And I thought, wow, this is really important because people are giving up their weekend to do this. And so it's that level of dedication that I think will make us continue to shine for the state. And again, I want to just echo Chancellor Christian and actually Deputy Chancellor Daisy Gonzalez for their work around this, and actually Lizette, because she's been really, really a champion around the housing work that is just really unprecedented. And I could see the excitement of the students at Santa Rosa about having those accommodations, and the fact that they've kept them low income, low cost, by not burdening the students with a lot of things that I know as running UC housing, I had to build into the rents. And so I think it really is a model to be followed. So I just want to give my congratulations to the whole team around that. Thank you.
Apologies, I forgot another event. There have been so many, but I think that's a wonderful thing. I just wanted to thank the Michelson 20 Million Minds Foundation for hosting their summit on student parents. It was their inaugural summit, I believe, and they really tried to model it after a similar one that was held for veterans. So they allowed me to make the opening remarks there and had a wonderful opportunity to meet so many student parents who are very excited about the work that we're doing. So thank you to the team over there.
Board Member Brown, then Board Member Medina.
So on August 3rd, I got to attend a virtual annual budget workshop. And thank you for not allowing my eyes to roll in the back of my head and for breaking it down as simply as you could, our very complex budget. On the 10th of August, I went to the dual enrollment Vision 2030 event at ELAC. And every question that popped into my mind, everyone talked about already on the stage. They were so very aware of the roadblocks, but everyone is focused on eye on the prize as well. So it was really wonderful to hear that and looking for solutions to the problems they know we face in implementation. Let's see. I had a conversation on the 22nd with someone about adult education. And then on August 29th, the Vision 2030 reception was absolutely lovely. And on September 22nd, LACCD did a joint symposium on course alignment. And I just did a few opening remarks, but also participated in the student panel, and it was a wonderful event. So kudos to the entire Chancellor's Office team. Kudos to the all the hosting community colleges that are helping with these efforts, and all of the faculty, employees, K-12 partners, industry folks that are showing up and all hands on deck to make all of this happen. Thank you.
Thank you, President. I won't be listing all the events I've participated, but thank you. I want to give a big thanks to the Chancellor's Office for actually extending the invitation to events such as Vision 2030, such as Southwestern College over at East Los Angeles College, the ribbon cutting ceremony at Santa Rosa Junior College, phenomenal event. Looking forward to next week. I'll be actually moderating a panel on Adult Learners Vision 2030 in San Diego. So I'm really excited about that. And also would be remiss if I didn't give a shout out to my predecessor on the Board of Governors, Colin Fitzgerald. I see him in the audience. Thank you for your for your past great, outstanding work for the community college students and on the Board of Governors, and actually for your continued advocacy for community college students. I truly appreciate it.
Thanks. I also see, hey, Colm, I also see Dolores Davidson in the back too. So nice to see you with us again. With no other board member comments, it's now time to open the public forum. Are there any public comments?
Public forum is now open. I will hand it over to Vice President Aguinaldo to begin with public remarks in Sacramento.
Thank you very much. We just have one public comment from Larry Galizio.
President Costa, when you were not here, no surprise, I started talking about the vision goals and the need to provide more flexibility for colleges to respond to their communities. And I mentioned the 50% law. And I see this as a great opportunity when we have a lot of new legislators who demand, rightly so, that we do a better job for equitable opportunity and success, especially for disproportionately impacted students. And diversification of faculty, there is a commitment from presidents and trustees. They understand that that's necessary. Small class sizes are fantastic when you can afford it. And again, it's meeting the community demand and the demands of our students and of California. And so this, again, there's no other state that has a law from 62 years ago that constrains colleges, community colleges, who want to respond to their communities. So let me just really quickly tell you all the elements that are, quote, on the non-instructional side
that are on the wrong side of the 50% law. Curriculum development by librarians and counselors, faculty release time for academic senate, instructional leadership,
30 seconds.
Being a curriculum chair, instructional support services, counselors, librarians, library support staff, financial aid, admissions and records, mental health, human resources, campus safety, technology agreements and software, utilities, finance and business services, transfer center. So these are all necessary costs to provide a safe environment, but they count against the 50% law. So help us make an adjustment and be part of the 21st century. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any online public comments?
There are. We have one hand raised. Jordan Campos, you have control of your mic and can address the board.
Good morning, Board of Governors. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I'm going to keep this brief. As a current member of the California Army National Guard, a veteran, and a student at Mount San Antonio College, there's some things I want to propose that I hope are considered for future legislation and opportunities for student veterans, especially those that are still serving as reservists in the armed forces. Number one, online asynchronous course flexibility for current members of the uniformed services, of course, due to our drill schedule, COVID-19 response, working with Cal Fire on the fires, and deployments to support and train people, famously California deployments to train the people of Ukraine. Number two, lab and clinical course equitability and academic progression. I believe currently lacking in medical and STEM programs for members of the uniformed services, we're often gone. And so we miss certain labs and clinicals for STEM majors or nursing environments. I hope it's considered that there's legislation that can protect us in this so that we're able to work around our schedules in a way. Number three, current academic progression in a program or course, if it could be frozen when we are activated or mobilized and present the orders that we receive from the state or federal government, so that when we return to complete a course, our progression is not wiped away and we're able to pick up where we left off. Number four, common sense transition exam and skills testing for service members that present with relevant training or experience in a given field, such as Army medics or Navy corpsmen trying to transition into the field of paramedic or nursing schools. There's currently bills in place for this, but the updating and faculty in place sometimes do not have the training to validate our skills testing. And I believe more work with the state military and federal military could help on this matter. Support for federal tuition assistance, number five, programs of current service members, such as federal tuition assistance, Army Ignite Ed, across all campuses. Currently, there is not support for federal tuition assistance of current service members at all campuses, if this could be considered
in the future. That is time. Thank you for your comments.
There are no other hands raised.
Thank you so much. Then I am happy to announce at 11:59, the business of the Board of Governors has concluded and we are adjourned.